God, I just pray tonight in Jesus' mighty name that you just begin to start from this day forward, from this moment on, just bragging on the Lord Jesus Christ. Just brag on God. I mean, some of you might be lost for words for a whole long time. Just don't even know where to start. Because of all the things and all the circumstances and all the disruptions and all the influences of the atmosphere. But maybe others of you, you just fear it right now, just so filled with thanksgiving to God, to brag on Him, to declare all that He's done, to just be in awe of all that He's purchased for us, all that He's purposed for us, all that He's given for us, the way that He loves us, His mercy that is everlasting, His joy that is majestic and wonderful. Every good thing, the Redeemer, the Healer, the Savior, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mande si caro mongesisi. Ebran si becchi promos. You can be seated. Be seated. You know, if you place a demand on the anointing, listen to me. If you place a demand on the anointing, if you get aggressive about having more of God, if you begin to cry out to Father, say, Father, in your grace, take me from the place that I am right now to that place that you've called me to. I'm so desperate. Unless you do it, I'm going to die. Father, I would faint unless I should believe that you would do this thing for me. You know what? You're going to have yourself a good time. Father actually demands the prayer, that bold prayer, that shameless prayer, the prayer of importunity, the banging prayer, the asking prayer, the knocking prayer. God, the hungry prayer, the thirsty prayer. Father, can't have it any other way than your way. I'm desperate for you. Somebody say, well, why does it got to be that way? Because the things that He wants to give us is so precious, they're so sacred, that with any other disposition, you would defile it. You would mess yourself up. You listen to me. These things are free, but they're not cheap. This is the glory of heaven that Father's willing to pour out upon you and I when we are so desperate, we don't want anything else. When all the other stuff that's a distraction, all the other things that are important that have touched our hearts and our emotions and have been issues to our lives suddenly become no issue at all. No, I don't care about it. I don't care about that. I don't care about this other thing. Hallelujah. How about Ramon Gesta? I care one thing, one desire, one purpose, one heart. To where that everything that we do ultimately, because we're so given over to this realm, that everything we do, everything is about the kingdom. Because we don't want to do nothing else. I'm a part of nothing. I don't want to do anything else. Why should I? Why waste my time? My heart's so captured by Him. I'm so captivated by Him. You know, tonight I'm going to minister to you on a very important verse of Scripture in Galatians 1:15 and 16. And we're just going to unfold these things to you tonight about how that God had purposed to, Paul said God had purposed to reveal His Son in him. And that is an event that happened right at the very beginning, right at the very moment. But I'm going to tell you right now, 20 years later, he's saying, oh, that I might win Christ. 25 years later, he's saying, oh, that I might know Him. He writes to the church, even though he can say and talk about how the glory of God and the fullness of Christ has been made manifest in him, how Christ is, he no longer lives, but it's Christ that lives. He talks about the church, about groaning and agonizing to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, to put on a heavenly body, a heavenly realm in a different dimension, because he'd already put on the Lord Jesus Christ, but in another dimension. Hallelujah. People, I'm going to tell you right now, you get into this hungering, thirsty program in God, you get into this needy place in God, listen, the world, if you're not needy, if you're not purposely, boldly going after those things which God has described, then you backsliding, you're going backwards. You're either advancing in God or you're backsliding because there's no neutral zone. Huh? You're on a steep hill. Put it in neutral, see what happens. Hallelujah. We're on an incline. Amen. And I'm down here yet. Down here later. Later. It's all down here from here. That's heaven. All right, and we on an incline. Amen. Park will give way. Park will give way. I said, park will give way. It's a gear. It's pulling the grade. Hallelujah. Not pulling the grade like in A or B. It's pulling the grade in the heel. Thank you, Jesus. I just want to stir you tonight. You know, I'll wake up in the morning and I'll go to the Word because I'm so hungry for God. I don't go to work because I got to go to the Word because that preacher said you got to pray and read your Bible and be good. I'm hungry for an encounter with Him, that I might know Him, that I might see Him, that I may lay hold on that for which I have been apprehended. That's what Paul said. He said, I've been apprehended by the Lord Jesus Christ, but I want to lay hold on Him. I want to know Him. I mean, think about it. Think about the fact of how that you know that God is in you. That God has purposed to reveal His Son, not a son, His Son, Christ Jesus, in you. And 30 years later, you're going, oh, that I might know Him in the power of His resurrection. Oh, that I might be conformed. Oh, that I might know Him in the fellowship of His sufferings, in the power being conformed unto His death, that if I might by any means also attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Hear the groaning? Hear the agonizing? Hear the desperation? Hear the neediness. Hear the state of hungry. Hear the state of thirsty. Hear the state of, I don't care. Nothing else matters to me. You can have the spirit of the world. I want the spirit of God. You can have the spirit of bondage. I'm taking the spirit of the Son. You can have the spirit of fear. I want the spirit of power and love. Can you hear that? You can have the spirit of filthiness. I'm going to have the spirit of holiness. Can you hear that? Can you hear that? Can you hear that? Jesus. God wants to seize our hearts. God wants to grab a hold of us in such a way He gets our full attention so that we begin to participate with Him in the things necessary for Him to be able to do through our lives what He's purposed on His calendar to do at this time. If we just go on in the status quo and our religious ideology and whatever it is that we think good about ourselves or whatever we know up to this point, and say it's good enough. And with that good enough, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going, it's good enough. You know what you're going to do when it's good enough? You're going to go on and your attention is going to be focused on other things. Because that's done. That's good enough. We're going to move on over here now. And I'm going to tell you right now, when heaven, when Christ Jesus, when the working of the Holy Ghost is good enough, but we all got that all taken care of, your distraction is going to be in the world. Your distraction is going to be in the pursuit of earthly interests and earthly things. What God wants to do in our life would really, truly, should captivate our attention 24 hours a day. It should be more than just some gnawing idea in the back of our head. Some additional interest in our lives. But Father, the call that Father has for us, His riches and glory made available to us. All of His spiritual blessings that He's blessed us with. All the inheritance that He's made available. This heirship in God, co-inheritorship with the Lord Jesus Christ. The privilege of being led and guided by the Holy Ghost, mentored and taught by God on a daily basis. Of how to walk in the beauty and the splendor of His ways. How to walk in the beauty of heaven. How to just know Him. How to see Him. How to have an encounter with Him. Paul saw Jesus on the road to Damascus. And all it did was make him desperate to see Jesus again. He reminded people, I too saw the Lord Jesus. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I saw the Lord Jesus as well. I was one born out of due season. 1 Corinthians 15. And all it did was make him hungry for God. He would say, I'm here to talk to people. They says, you know, they just commonly act like that they've said, they've seen this vision or seen that vision. I'm telling you right now, when you get a vision from God, it's like a fire on the inside of you. It burns. You don't have to have a second vision, not a third vision. You get a vision from God, it burns on the inside of you. It burns on you day in, day out. It's there. It's in your life. There's a call of God. There's a mandate. There's an imprint from heaven. Hallelujah. From the day, the very moment in time that you were born of the Spirit, when you were born of God, from the very moment in time, a gifting and a call of God came upon your life. And Father is watching over it and hastening to bring it to pass. Father is earnest about having the oppressed go free. He's earnest and desperate and desirous. Father, I'm talking about Father. Father, who alone knows when he's going to wrap all of this up. Even Jesus doesn't know. Father, whom Jesus said, Father, keep through thine own name those that you've given unto me. Father, who's got a long patience waiting for the precious fruit of the earth to come forth, says, dearly beloved, just be patient unto the coming of the Lord, because I'm going to have the precious fruit of the earth first. I'm going to have the precious fruit first. I'm going to have the precious fruit. I'm going to have reproduced within my house, within the people who are not called by my name, that which Jesus purchased at Calvary, rose from the grave in power to give, and is poured out from on high. The promise of the Father. You know, I want to talk to you about the glory of the Holy Ghost. Thanks, Son. Hallelujah. Parostaranea she. Say potestora mokinga bateya. If you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost tonight, shame on you. It's your fault, not God's. Because he'll give it to anyone who asks, and he's poured out his spirit upon all flesh. He's made a way. Scripture says the fool can't even err in it. That's what he says. He said it's so clear, it's so established in God. Father's made it so easy. Now, come on, people. I'm going to tell you right now. I pray in Jesus' name tonight you get shame to yourself and grab a hold of God and receive what he has for you. Amen.
Amen.
And begin to understand what it means to live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit and be led by the Spirit. Hallelujah. What it means to accept and acknowledge these things which God has done in our lives. Open up your Bibles here and just look at Galatians chapter 1. And thanks, baby. Things Solomon Shea Porane, I said, Tipuxed. 1 Corinthians Shele Canasta, Galatians chapter 15 and 16. And Paul said that the Lord purposed in his grace to separate him from his mother's womb. And really, you know, I just want to break into verse 15 and say, God, who chose, and grab verse 16, to reveal his son in me. God, who chose, he had this experience under the road to Damascus, he saw the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, blinding glory of the radiant light of the gospel. Stood there in front of him. Changed everything about him. But then another thing happens, and suddenly comes to realize by the Spirit of wisdom and revelation, he comes to realize that Father purposed to reveal himself, to reveal his son, his only begotten son, Christ Jesus, in him. And as soon as he understood this, he immediately, what did he do? And he got to run around and say, hey, guys, you just don't imagine. You can't imagine what I just heard. You can't imagine who I am. You can't imagine what special things God has done for me. No, he went immediately into separating himself and said, I got to understand this. I got to know you. I had to lay hold on you. He separated himself. He separated himself. He went away apart from everybody else for 3 years. And God there downloaded to him the full expression of what it meant to have the Son revealed in us. And thus, God gave him the whole declaration of the new covenant plan. Hallelujah. So that you and I could more fully understand those things about really this whole theme about Christ Jesus being formed in us, about Christ Jesus being birthed in us. I mean, who do you think the new man is? Huh? Who do you think the new creation is? Do you think that it just, you know, something different from God? No, it's created in him. It's reproduced after him. After his seed, he produced a fruit of the same kind and the same likeness. Oh, yeah, he did. Well, just start digging through some verses of scripture to kind of help you understand this. I want you to get on the, same page with God and start beholding what God did and what God's done and who you are in him. Quit thinking something different about yourself. Huh? Satan was able to come. See, the serpent was able to beguile Eve, to convince her that she was something, that she wanted to be something different than what God had purposed her to be. He said, God has known the day that you eat, you should be like him, having the knowledge of good and evil. See, Satan began to create within her a subtle, through subtlety, a message, and a vision of being something different than God purposed and created her and shaped her and formed her to be. And be with them today, right now, the same spirit of darkness, the same satanic power is it trying his best to stop you and stop me and stop anyone who's received this wonderful gospel from believing the things which God has said about us. Tonight we want you to look and see. Tonight God the Holy Ghost is brooding in this place. Tonight God the Holy Ghost, I can see him hovering right over top of you saying, my, I'd like to get in here. My, I'd like to change some things here. My, I'd like to fill them with holy emotions. My, I'd like to bust out of them like rivers of living water. My, I wish that what they were singing about, oh God, I want your rivers to flow through here. I wish that that become the sole desire of their heart. Because Father is a jealous God. He's not gonna allow us to have other gods alongside of him and be partaker of his glory and partaker of all the rest of the stuff that goes on in the world. He's not gonna have a mixture. Somehow we got to get burned out and tired of all the other stuff that goes on in the world around us and all of our other interests. God's got to become the sole interest of our heart. And when we begin to see him as he is and what he's prepared for us, what he's planned for us, it's very captivating. All of a sudden we go, wow, God's got the best plan possibly that I could possibly have. I'm going to quit being a multitasker. I'm going to get focused now. I'm going to get rid of spiritual ADD. I'm gonna start specializing in these things and the opportunities that the Holy Spirit's made available to me. Listen to this verse of scripture. I'm gonna hit you with a bunch of verses of scripture here. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. Look here. Hallelujah. Say, my heart is open.
My heart is open.
Wide, wide open.
Wide, wide open.
To consider you, Lord. Don't say that. Only for you. We got to get out of the considering him. We're going to consider you and consider your retirement plan and your bonus plan and the salary and the benefits. Because we got a couple of options running right now too as well. Jesus, help us. God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness. God commanded his light to shine out of darkness. Hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. You have had, and Paul makes this as an encounter for every single person, not just for one person. And he uses the language that really is best fitting to his own personal experience on the road to Damascus. But now he describes and declares it, that it's an event that has already happened to everybody. There's something that has happened to you. And somebody looks at me and goes, oh, really? Yeah, it really did happen. It's just that maybe the God of this world would put some blinders on you. Maybe somehow other influences have kept you from moving forward in the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him so that you can understand what it is he's done. But the light of the glorious gospel has shined. The knowledge of God has shined into you as well to give you this knowledge that God has come and made his dwelling place here in our lives. I can see this is going to be a little bit hard tonight. What you guys been doing between the meetings? I can feel the need to go to work. I have to pull my shirt off and roll up. You know, come on. I'm going to have to get after the thing, man. Come on, dear people. I shouldn't have to pick at some hard ground here tonight. I should be able to sow some seed in some well-tilled, well-prepared soil. I shouldn't have to be dealing with no fallow ground here tonight. I shouldn't have to be laboring to get you a breakthrough out of your doubt and into your faith. There should be honest and sincere heart. We're not going to sow seeds in fallow ground. We're going to till. I've done tilled up the soil. Your soil is supposed to be tilled up. The seed of the good word of God is supposed to be there, present, right now, able to now bring forth fruit, spring up in your life. I got to get you out of your natural mind and into the spiritual mind so you understand what I'm saying. I'm going to have to get you out of a realm of your natural thinking, of your natural cares. Because I'm going to tell you right now, the natural man cannot receive the things of the Spirit of God. They don't make any sense. It just doesn't make any sense. It doesn't seem valuable. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if you sit under the good word of God and don't do any, and not willing to change, that is a terrible thing. And I believe that every person in this place here tonight, you're willing to change. You desire to change. You desire to let God's grace take you from the place that you are into the realm that He's called you to be in, to exist in, the things that He's called you to. One of the most important things that you and I have got to begin to realize is that He's purposed to reveal Christ Jesus in us. Amen. That we're not supposed to be alive unto ourselves. We're supposed to be alive unto Him. That the Lord Jesus put forth a call and says, come dwell in me. Hello. Come dwell in me. Come let me dwell in you. The whole activity and the whole working of the Holy Ghost, which you and I are supposed to be filled with, baptized in. Some of you don't look like it. Some of you look like you've been baptized in something else. You do. You look sleepy, tired, kind of, you know. God, the Holy Ghost doesn't have access to your emotions and passions right now. Something else has been bothering you. Something else got you. You got intercepted on the way to church with some other interest, with some other concern. You got a need for something. I'm telling you right now, you make God the whole sole purpose of your life. You make Him the sole object of your trust. Hallelujah. You don't care about nothing else, man. Hallelujah. Basta carinaya. Hande pera si prosuti. Esten. Molandi. Merasta ne pekista. Marasta carinista perineia. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. I've got some things I want to tell you about this verse of Scripture, but I'm not allowed to until you're in the right state of mind. And so I'm probably just have to work around here tonight. I'll probably have to just do some plowing. Who knows, we might have to get some dynamite out and blow up some rocks. I don't know. We have to clear a bit of land here tonight so we can come back later and then begin to describe these things that Father wants to impart to you. Do you know that the Word of God ministered by the Spirit of God will result in you actually experiencing what God declared? You know, Father's Word is so powerful. It's absolutely, I don't care what kind of resistance it's met with. It cannot be stopped or put down except but by the will of men. You think about tonight, dear people, where God has called us to come over into this realm of understanding just basic things about the fact that we've been made partakers of His divine nature. The light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ is shining in our heart, a radiant. I mean, it's almost like when you read here in verse 6, it's like this divine lightning bolt done struck you. You see that? The light of shine out of darkness has shined into your heart to give you the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's what Paul saw. He saw the face and he became blind. Scales came over his eyes. I mean, he stared until he couldn't see no more. And so the Lord said, you're staring at a blinding light right now. It's the blinding light of what God has done for you through His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, where He changed you by the very power of the gospel that reproduced and recreated, as it were, Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is Paul's message. Go ahead, take a few minutes to yawn, and then we'll come back to this. This is Paul's whole message. This is Paul's whole message. Christ is in you. God, the living God, dwells on the inside of you. Come on. I mean, I'm not really expecting a whole lot of yells. I'm expecting a whole lot of manifestation of the power of the Holy Ghost through you. I'm expecting a spiritual, divine spiritual response, not a human response. You have to deal with that. I'm going to tell you right now, you allow God, the Holy Spirit, to draw you into a deeper prayer life, and it's going to be on you. But I know about all the other stuff that's going on because you're so busy at work. When you get home, you're so tired, you got enough time for the Lord. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Reality of it is, when you begin to understand this glorious place that you and I have been allowed to come into His presence and begin to interact with Him, it is so exhilarating. It is so thrilling. It is so overwhelming. It is such the definition of life. You will run to the place. You won't try to find opportunity to do some religious function. We want you to know about it. We want you to understand these things. I mean, think about how long I've been pleading with some of you, and some of you still don't pray an hour a day. You haven't ever found the glory of it. And it's hard to, and you know what I'm saying? You still don't even, I mean, I'm just saying, I just use an hour a day just because, my goodness. That is kind of like a scriptural note of the bare minimum, you know? Jesus said, can't you pray with me 1 hour? Hey, that's the bare minimum. Can't you pray with me 1 hour? Don't you know that the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak? Don't you understand? Huh? Don't you understand how to allow the anointing to be activated in your life? Yes, the Holy Ghost lives here. Yes, we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost. Yes, He's with us and in us. But God demands a participation that results in you and I being filled with the Spirit. Think about it. The activation of letting God arise. The activation of letting God become the one, the master, the one who's in control, the one who touches deeply our emotions so nothing else can touch them. Oh, listen to me. Your tomorrow would be different. If you would begin to understand what's being said by the Spirit of the Lord and allow God to put within the inside of you, the ability to participate with them, which He wants to do, which He does actually through the new birth and comes along then to strengthen us by His Spirit, amen, continually, so that we can be rooted and grounded in these things, amen, hallelujah, so that you can get rooted and grounded over here in this fellowship, hallelujah, dwelling in God, just laying hold of the joy and laying hold of the love and laying hold of the peace and laying hold of the expressions of the Spirit of God, because you got to understand, have you received another Spirit? There's the spirit of the world, and it will influence you in every way that is opposed to God or a distraction, because Satan will transform himself into an angel of light to deceive you, even as he deceived Eve, beguiled. Is it the spirit of the world that you have, or is it the Spirit of God? Because the Spirit of God is going to begin to express these things of the Spirit of the Son. Is going to begin to put upon you such a divine mandate, such a divine pull, that it's easy for you to go right over into that. You're just desperate. You're more hungry for the Word of God than you are for your breakfast food.
Amen.
You're more hungry for that wonderful interaction that comes to this place of the prayer of the Spirit than you are for a drink of water. You're a thirsty man whose thirst can only be quenched by the Spirit of the Lord. Maybe you're going to begin. If you'll just grab yourself by the nape of your neck and say, okay, buddy, you come over here right now. You're going to start living different. You're going to start living to be the man that God created you to be. You're not going to just go on saying, I'm filled with the Spirit. The Spirit of God lives on the inside of me, that He's with me, and not have that activation of being continually filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Because that's where you grow, and that's where you mature, and that's where you become more responsive to what God is doing, more sensitive to what God is doing, more receptive of that which He's supplying. We want to get rid of the layers. When we get all rid of all the layers, because I'm telling you right now, you get rid of the layers, you can have everything God's got for you. Because God doesn't leave anybody in sickness and disease and sin and pain and sorrow and death. He doesn't leave anybody there. Maybe many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers you from every one of them. Hallelujah. Now, many are the afflictions of the righteous, therefore God made lawyers and doctors. Jesus, help us. Know ye not that ye're the temple of the Holy Ghost? Know ye not that God has come to live and dwell in you? Why don't you begin to acknowledge it? Why don't you begin to look in the glorious light of it? Why don't you begin to stare in the face of Jesus? Somebody said, oh, I want to have the encounter that Paul had with Jesus. God wants you to have that encounter. How about right now? Amen. How about tomorrow? How about all the way through tomorrow? It's an opportunity. It's something that is available to you. It's actually something that has happened. And if you're not careful, the God of this world will blind you from seeing it. That's what he said in verse 4. Verse 4 is connected to verse 6. This is a reality. This is what God has done for every single person who's been willing to call upon his name. In fact, the glorious gospel, the light of the gospel has shined to all men everywhere. And then you see various different degrees of how verse 4 has played out in people's lives. So you look at verse 4 right back here in verse 4, and we see that he says, verse 3, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid from those who are lost. Are you lost? Do you know where you're at? Do you know where God's at? Good. Now, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them that believe not, lest they should see the light of the glorious gospel. Have you seen the light of the glorious gospel? Is the lightning bolts of heaven, have you been struck by the lightning bolts of heaven? Is the brightness of his glory that he's commanded to shine out of darkness? My goodness, when God said, lit up the sun, when he said, light shine, I'm telling you, an event happened on the day of creation. When Paul had an encounter with Jesus, an event happened. Think about it. How much of the day do you walk out a day unconscious of the presence of the Lord? How much of the day do you live completely captivated and consumed with whatever it is that your vocation or your interest or your distraction is? Think about it. Because I'm telling you right now, that is not something God is doing. That's just something that the spirit of the world is doing. That's not something the spirit of son is doing. That's just something that the spirit of bondage is doing. That's not something the spirit of power is doing. That's something that the spirit of fear is doing. That's an influence not of the spirit of the Lord, who's come to take us into a place of a relationship with God that supersedes, that's bigger, that's more glorious, more impactive than anything else that goes on in our life. When we see our whole purpose and identity, that I was born of God simply so that Christ Jesus may be revealed through me. That I come to recognize that I was born of God by the incorruptible seed, by the word of God. And now, beloved, we are the sons of God. As many as received him, he gave them power. As many as that would believe, he gave them power. He gave them the authority to be his sons. Beloved, now are we the sons of God? To think about the reality of being an heir with God and a co-heir with God as you get overrun with all your other interests and thoughts and nonsense. It's time to start functioning in the Spirit. It's time to start walking in the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit. Somebody said, how do I do that? Start living by the Word. How do I do that? Get desperate with God to where you, oops, I'm late for work again. Sorry, boss, I'm late for work. Man, I got caught in prayer. I was just raptured away in prayer. I'm sorry. You should try it sometime. I guarantee you late for work because you got raptured away in prayer. I'm telling you, you get favor with the boss because he'll see something on you. He'll feel something. Hallelujah. You'll be a blessing to his company. But I'm telling you right now, most people don't run any risk of doing that. Huh? They might be late for a whole bunch of other reasons. Oh, just don't look down at the ground. Not now. Don't go from shouting and yelling, looking down at the ground. Now give me that in and out, up and down, wavering back and forth in the things of the Spirit, back in your own stuff. Hello. Come on. Come on, it's high time, man. It's high time that you begin to lay hold on that which God has given you, that which you've been. God arrested you. He in His mercy and His love, He came and grabbed a hold of you. I mean, I like to say this, that Jesus and the Holy Ghost team roped you. Some of you understand what that is because you're not from the country, from the city. You know, but I'm telling you right now, when you've been team roped, I'm telling you, there's just, you ain't moving. You're going to the ground. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And they branded you. Praise God. Praise Hallelujah. God. Put a seal on you.
Yes.
Huh? Quit running with another herd.
Yes.
Quit looking for another field.
Yes.
You know what I'm going to do tomorrow? You know what I'm going to do tomorrow? I'm going to do what I'm doing right now, what I did today. I'm going to stare in the glass. I'm going to look in the mirror. I got a looking mirror. I got a looking glass. Hallelujah. Look at verse 18 in chapter 3. I have a looking glass. What I'm going to do is I'm going to look in the mirror and see the sun.
Amen.
I'm going to look in the mirror and see the glory of God. Hallelujah. I'm going to go look in the mirror and see the light and the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. I'm going to do it with an unveiled face. I'm not going to have a veil over my face that hides the glory of the new covenant from me. I'm going to have the veil taken off. Hallelujah. Think with me a little bit. He says, but we with unveiled faces, behold in the mirror. Somebody says, oh, well, we behold in the glass. It's like when you take a welder's glass and you look at the sun. Ain't nothing about no welder's glass over here looking at the sun. Hello, this is mirror. You don't use a mirror to look at the sun. Just look at a mirror. It's a mirror. We with unveiled faces. We without welder's glasses on. Ah, hallelujah. Come on. It just amazes me sometimes the things people say. We with unveiled faces without any welder's glasses on or welder's hood or whatever. Look in the mirror. Go read about it, theologian, Greek scholar, those of you that are watching me on the web right now, or you're watching on the YouTube, if you don't understand what I'm saying, you can verify it. The Greek word is mirror. It's the looking glass. It's what you see your reflection in. It's not what you see through. Can't help it. King James, I don't know what their problem was. Open face, glass. Open face. What is open face? Huh? What does that mean? Unveiled. Because it didn't say open face on the rest of the verse of Scripture. It said unveiled. It said veiled. And now it's now unveiled. Why don't we go from veiled to open? You know what I'm saying? It's been where everybody's confused. There's no blinders anymore. There's no God of this world that's supposed to be able to run interference with that which God has done. We're supposed to be able to look upon the glory of the Son. We're supposed to have this wonderful, continuous, ongoing manifestation of His divine presence and power. Be thrilled with it. And when you are, Satan is going to do everything he possibly can do from you having that, because he don't stand a chance with you standing there in the wind of divine glory. I'm not talking about no breeze. I'm talking about a wind, a hurricane, gale force wind of divine glory. Hallelujah. He don't have a chance when you so filled up with His asaremefi, so filled up with everything that He Himself is. When will you stop being who you are and start being what He's made you to be? When will you stop looking at yourself in the mirror and start looking at Him and seeing His divine reflection? Looking in the mirror and there with an unveiled face, we look in the mirror. Look at this. We look in the mirror and behold the glory. I look in the mirror. What do I see?
Glory.
Mirror, mirror on the wall. No, I look in the mirror. What do I see? Look in the mirror. What do I see? I look in the mirror of my memory. I look in the mirror of my thoughts. I look in the mirror of my reflections and my contemplation. And what do I see? Many times failure. Many times things that produce shame, hurt, weakness. Many times things that produce within us doubts and unbelief. We're supposed to be, listen, your former life is passed away. It doesn't exist anymore. Anybody that brings up a memory of it is insane. They're crazy. They're mistaken. They have mixed you up with someone else. You ever had anybody walk up to you and say, you know, recently I was with Daniel and I were doing something, and somebody said, hey, I know you. Don't I know you? And I'm like, I don't think you know me. You fight fires? No. In fact, I start them. I didn't say that. But, you know, I left it alone. I don't want to be too wild. But nonetheless, people mistake you for somebody else. No, you're mistaking me for somebody else. That's not me. Satan will constantly come and try to cast another identity, another purpose on you. Try to always make your breakthrough in the reality of who God is to you and through you. Something that's going to happen in the future when you get to be a little bit better. When you grow up just a little bit more. When you get to be a little bit stronger, when you have a little bit more anointing. Somebody came up and wanted me to pray for him today and said, you know, I just want an increase of anointing if I have any at all. Man, listen, you got to listen to the wrong voice if you have any at all. That isn't humility, that's stupidity. Forgive me, I mean, I'm sorry, but I don't want you to be stupid no more. Are you listening to me? I'm not telling who you are. You might not even be here tonight. Just let everybody say, nobody's looking around with curiosity. He's given you an anointing that you may know. He's given you anointing that you don't need any man to teach you, because God's on the job, in the program, teaching you, showing you that you are dwelling in Him, that you do abide in Him, that you have your life in Him, that He's living in you, that you possess the Son. He's yours. You're His. You a new creation. You've been made a partaker of the divine nature. What on earth are you doing? That's the problem. It's earth. And it's time you start living your days in heaven. It's time you, I pray tomorrow morning, you wake up in the morning and you say, I'm walking out days of heaven upon this earth. I'm living in glory divine. God has revealed His God has purposed to reveal Christ Jesus, His only begotten Son, in me. And you know, when you think about it, He is purpose. When I understand, Paul said, when I understood that God had chosen to reveal His Son in me, He takes so many dimensions of redemption and loads them into one word. He loads into that word, He chose to reveal Christ Jesus in me. He chose to reveal the new creation in me. He chose to reveal not something different from His only begotten Son, but a Son created in His only begotten Son who's one with Him, who doesn't exist outside of Him. Wow. Yeah. Think about that. Amen. Just how much room is the powers of darkness going to be able to come and begin to work on you and tell you about how much better what He's got for you and within the system of the world and within the framework of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the pride of life. How much more He's got for you when you're so filled with the glory of God, when you're so filled with the riches of heaven and the divine authority, which all other powers are subject to. Now, Paul gets real radical about this. Think about this. Think about this one. Paul gets real radical about this one. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Philippians 2:5. Let this mind which was in Christ Jesus be also in you.
Amen.
Uh-oh. What's that? What are we talking about now? To be made partakers of His glory? To share in His glory? To be made partakers of His righteousness? To be made partakers of His holiness? To truly be so radically transformed by the power of God that everything is new and everything is of God? People, this is the light of the gospel that is shining radiantly into your heart right now, giving you the knowledge of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Right now, at this very moment. And some of you are giving me a look like, oh, really? When did that happen?
Praise the Lord. I'm glad.
When? It's kind of on the same note of rivers, of the expression of the life of God exploding out of you. It's just that you're more comfortable with that one because you sung a song about that one. Remember that song? I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the blind, lame to walk and the blind to see. When? When did that happen? When? If the word of God would begin to dwell in our mouth and we begin to declare those things which God has spoken about us and we begin to believe those things which he has said, the report that God has given, all of a sudden these things the Father has announced about who we are would suddenly begin to be revealed. You know, it would suddenly begin to be displayed. Do you know why that God purposed to reveal his son in Paul? You know why? First and foremost, he revealed himself to Paul. Then he showed to Paul that I'm going to reveal myself. God's going to be revealed through you. Wow. Because God's on the inside of you. Whoa. And now what he's going to do is he's going to reveal within your life the resurrected Christ Jesus, the resurrected only begotten Son. Why? Why? Do you know why? It's actually in the rest of the verse. So that he might proclaim him to the nations. So that he might proclaim him to the nations. You want to go try to proclaim Jesus to the nations and he can't be seen in you? God has made you a living epistle written of God and read of men. God has made you, Jesus Christ is the living word, and you and I have been born of the incorruptible seed of the word by the word of God. Now also to be those living epistles, living in Christ Jesus, that the living word is living in me. Hallelujah. So that the word of God is nigh me, in my mouth and in my heart. So that I may speak out those things which God has declared. So that I may begin to give my mouth to that good seed of the word of God. So I begin to give my mind and my thinking, my attitudes and my expressions to those good things that the word of God has declared. And now through that, begin to properly deal with all the things that are saying that I'm something different. That wants to pull me into another identity. I watch it happen all the time. Oh, what do you do? Oh, well, I'm a mechanic. I'm a doctor. I'm a lawyer. I'm a genius. I'm one of the best people that have ever lived. I do this. And it's all about what you do within the framework of your natural life. If you were a trash collector, I think you would come up with something else. You would be so bold. Oh, I'm a trash collector. I go pick up garbage every morning. That would be much to boast in, right? Are you with me?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm a this, oh, I'm a that. I mean, what happens when the reality of Christ Jesus begins to become so big on the inside of us that that's our boast, that becomes what we're about? I this is who I am. God lives and dwells, abides in me. I'm all about coming, going everywhere and revealing Christ Jesus right now in the earth. I'm a person, you now talking to a person who can demonstrate the living God. You want to see Jesus? I can show him to you. How many people have, I want you to listen to me right now. All liars will have their lot part in like a fire. I want to know right now by the uplifted hand, how many of you people have that kind of boldness? Where you look at people and say, you want to see Jesus? I'm here to show him to you. I can reveal him right now. Dear people, I'm going to tell you, that's a transition of the life. You're not going to call yourself by any other name anymore. You're not going to boast about all the things that you are and what all you can do. When all of a sudden Christ Jesus has been so revealed to you, and now you are captivated by the reality that he can be revealed through you, that you can demonstrate him, that you can show him to a lost and dying world who wants to see him. Huh? And it's fine. It's fine maybe if you're just talking to somebody that looks healthy and everything. But if you're talking to this person who's basically a paraplegic, I heard about a man of God, and the Lord told him, I want you to start moving in miracles and signs and wonders. And he's like, okay, Lord, I'll do whatever you want me to do. And so he was ministering in India, and he says, there's anybody in here, you're sick, you're diseased in your body. And a woman raised her hand, and he's all excited because, you know, she stood and she raised her hand, so she wasn't crippled, she wasn't paralyzed, she could see, and obviously she could hear because she responded to what he said. So he felt he was in pretty good condition now. Are you with me? Okay, praise God. He was moving signs, wonders, and miracles, and he's really given me a very healthy specimen to start with. The next thing she points to her daughter, and her son or her daughter was completely paralyzed and crippled. Ruh-roh. Now, are we here to be fruit providers? Are we the person now that can reveal Jesus? Hallelujah. And so it's a beautiful thing. It's a great story because, you know, he begins to pray a religious prayer over her. Oh, God, your infinite wisdom and divine grace and mercy. If you can hear us now, please come and intervene and do a work that only you can do. And he starts praying this kind of prayer, and nothing's happening. And he stands back and he goes, Lord, I know that you told me. I know you spoke to me. And out of that, the Spirit of the Lord told him, gave him an understanding to speak in the first person with divine authority. I charge you in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out. Leave this body alone. Be made perfectly whole now. He spoke one as one of authority. Now all of a sudden, there's a transition in his life. That moment, that day, that time, a whole transition in his life took place. A whole ministry began. Preacher for many years suddenly has an encounter with suddenly the blinders are being removed. Suddenly those things that Satan runs interference, the god of this world that would blind not only fully but also in part. You know, when we think about Paul's prayer when he said, I pray to the Father and ask him continually to give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him so that your eyes will be open. What does that mean? What does that mean? They're shut. Right. That was not a trick question. If your eyes need to be open, they shut. Okay, they're either shut because you're sleeping, or they need to be open because you're blind. And how do you get blind? How is it that Paul could be talking to this way to a people who have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, who have been born of the Spirit, who blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm, and all the other things he's already said about them? And now he says, I'm praying this spirit of wisdom. People have already been baptized in the Holy Ghost. I'm praying the spirit of wisdom, revelation, the knowledge of him, so that you begin to understand what God's purpose to do through you. What Father separated you from your mother's womb for? What he called you by his grace for? Why the Spirit of the Lord came upon you and brought forth the treasures of heaven and produced a new creation in you? Hallelujah. I mean, I feel like I could just get people to say, if I could just get you to believe that God is in you, hallelujah, and with you. That God, the only God, Christ Jesus, is in you. That God, the Holy Ghost, God, the only true Holy Ghost, he's in you. And he's not sitting there going, man, I hate being here. I tell you, this is just a terrible place to live. He's not doing that. That he's there and he's happy to be there. And you've come to a place of relationship with him that you know that he's happy to live on the inside of you. That he's trying to get a word in edgewise, I know. Because you got just so, you're going wide open. With so many ideas just rushing through your head, he didn't hardly have even a chance to get a suggestion yet. Huh? But he's in you to begin to recognize, man, when you can begin to recognize that God is in you, that he lives and abides and dwells in you, and he's pleased to dwell with you, that this new birth, that this new creation has brought this to pass, there's going to be no more condemnation. There's not going to be more. Fear's not going to be able to work. Intimidation is not going to be able to work. Doubt's going to barely have an opportunity to even give you a suggestion. How is it then we can grab a hold of a walk with the Lord Jesus Christ in such a way that we can, with unveiled faces, begin to behold in the mirror the glory of the Lord and be changed into the same image. Wait a second. Saint change. Saint what? What did I say? Image. Same image. Change is the same image. What? Huh? What was the next verse you wanted to... What was the next thing you wanted? What was the last point? What's another point? Give me another point. The image. Change in the same image. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello. Knock, knock. Anybody home? Yeah. Lights are home. Lights are on. Is there anybody in there?
Yeah,
image. Changed in the same image. What happens when you begin to acknowledge what God has done? What happens when you begin to find a way in which you can interact with the glory? Did you know that Jesus said the glory that Father gave to me, I've given to you. I've given to them. Do you know how to engage in the glory? Do you know how to lay hold on the glory? Do you understand the movings of the Spirit that take place in the meeting are all about you beginning to participate with the Holy Ghost in such a way that it doesn't matter where you're at, you can begin to interact with the divine glory. You can begin to receive from Him. You can begin to engage in that realm. Hallelujah. You begin to engage in that realm and you give yourself more to interacting with Him in the heavenly realm and the realms of the Spirit and the realms of His divine glory. I'm telling you, the power of God's going to be made manifest to your life in an ever-increasing way with the demonstration of that wonderful glory who is the Holy Ghost. Because, listen, I'm telling you right now, Father, come on. Father's purpose that His glory be flowing out of us like rivers, but sometimes I wonder if there's any, you know, like squirts. If there's any moments of just something. We don't have the capability on our own to do these things. You don't have the capability to stand in for God.
I'm standing in for God tonight.
You don't have the capability to function and flow and operate in the signs, wonders, and miracles. You can't do anything without the Holy Ghost. You can't do anything without Him. Jesus said, I can do nothing without the Father. It's not me that does the work. It's Father in me that does the work. Where is the acknowledgement taking place in our life? Where is the opportunity that we give the Spirit of the Lord to begin to overwhelm us? Because I'm telling you, He doesn't come and force Himself upon us. It is a force of our will. It is where we engage in relational and interaction with Him. And that's called prayer. It's beautiful to come to a place where you can always hear God speak and hear His voice. And you don't learn to hear God's voice or come to a place where you're always hearing God speak until you start speaking to Him. When you begin to start speaking with Him, and I'm in day not speaking to Him, telling about how bad your day went and how disappointed you are with things. Because He's like not even there, you know. That's not even a realm of faith. You're not going to get God in the realm of doubt and unbelief. You're not going to get God in a realm of darkness. He to come and interact with God, it is a realm of faith. It's a realm of the Holy Ghost. You're never going to get Him out of the realms of the Holy Spirit. You'll never get Him out of the realms of the expression of that which God the Holy Ghost is doing. That's why if you can learn how to brag on God, if you can learn how to praise Him, if you can learn how to glorify Him and magnify Him through thanksgiving and declaring all that He's done for you,
amen.
There's a transition that begins to take place in your life. I mean, you can learn a lot just from Daniel. If you just decide, you know what, I'm going to do this. Daniel, three times a day, he knelt down and just praised the Lord and gave thanks to the Lord for all the things that God has done for him, all the things that the Father is and all who he is. He didn't get down and give thanks for all the circumstances, situation necessary that he was living in, because he was living in captivity and he was one of the most persecuted races on the earth. He didn't talk to God about all the things that he himself was. He talked to God and declared to God all the things that Father is, who God is. He acknowledged who Father is and what Father is doing. Three more yawns. You want to take a 5-minute nap real quickly and then we'll come back? You know, there is a force of your will. A force of your will that lays hold on things that you've got to have. I guarantee you, when it becomes a threatening situation, the force of that will really comes to bear. I would never ever have anything in God unless I actively engage in the force of my will to go over into that place that Father has made ready for me and access that I have to Him by the Holy Ghost. If I don't know how to do that, if I don't know how to engage in that realm of just letting the things of the Spirit begin to build in me, huh? Where I began to myself to be. Maybe this done a little bit of basata la lenemy, Mickey of Rabbi. Beginning with a stone to a little bit of it, you see. Speaking in a master right now. Building up myself in my most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Just staying there until all of a sudden it goes to another level. But it's not my energy. It's not my strength. It's His power at work in my life. Now I'm beginning to give place to Him. And it may start off as something that looks, you know, somewhat weak and somewhat, you know, less than the glory and the power of God. But I stay right there in that realm. And that realm of divine power and glory begins to be expressed in a greater dimension, in a greater expression of who God is. And why should it find a ceiling or a threshold in our lives? Why is it that many people, it almost as though if you hear them begin to allow the Holy Spirit to speak through them, it sounds exactly what they were doing 25 years ago, 30 years ago. Or even 5 years ago, or even 2 years ago. It's not advanced. It's still just the same thing. When God would cause every dimension of the expression of His glory and the expression of His presence and the expression of the knowledge of the Lord and the expression of the very person of Jesus Christ who's earnestly agonizing to be revealed through us. While we're sitting here with all these other things that we've got to do. And it's a terrible thing when your body gets tired, you know. When your body gets tired, it'll really rule your spirit. Hello? Right. When your body gets tired, it'll really rule your spirit. And your body's tired and it's hot. My goodness, and you're sweating. Now you know. How we ever have enough anointing to get past that? There is a realm of the anointing to get past all that. There is a realm of participation with God. And I tell you, you show me the people that are more excited about worship. You show me the people that engage in an interaction of worship. I'll show you the people who through the process of the meeting will receive more and more of the things of the Spirit. You show me the people that are basically trying to participate. You can see, and they're just trying. They're trying to look good, you know. They're trying to participate. Bless their heart. At least they're not just sitting there. You know, looking oddly. You're not going to really receive much. Because receiving from God is all about a participation with Him. And it's not just any kind of participation. It's the participation that God the Holy Spirit teaches us. God the Holy Ghost has come to teach us how to worship Him in spirit and truth. He's come to teach us how to talk to the Father. He's come to teach us how to pray. Hallelujah. He's going to pray with all prayer and supplication through us. You want faith to build in your life? You need to pray more in the Holy Ghost. You want Christ Jesus to be revealed in your life in a greater way? You've got to give greater place to the Spirit of the Lord. You're going to have to be willing to set aside time in the day, as challenging as that may be, for you to be filled with all the glory of God. Isn't that funny? Ha, 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 ha. That is ridiculous, isn't it? That we're going to have to try to find time in the day to set apart, to be filled with all the glory of God? I mean, what am I talking to? Are you listening to me? That's the mindset. It's a mind-blinding spirit. It's a spirit of slumber and sleep. It's a realm in which we don't really know or fully grasp the things for which God has called us into His glory to live in and have. And so here's the agony of Paul. I pray that you will receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him. The people who have received the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him and are actively participating with spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him have their eyes open and they can see what is the glory of His inheritance in them. His Son in me, Christ in me, the power and the glory of God living and dwelling here. Somebody said, heaven's brass and I can't get my prayers through. Listen, first of all, heaven's not brass, and even if it was, no problem, because God's with you. He's on the inside of you. The answer to your prayer, the God that needs to supply all that you have need of, is walking around on the inside of you. Hallelujah. All you got to do is be willing now to participate with him. Let God arise. Another way to express that is to be filled with the Spirit. And so to be filled with the Spirit is you and I simply giving the Holy Ghost the right to now to become the primary power and influence in our life instead of our own passions, our own interests, our own problems, our own circumstances, our own needs, our own whatever. Father, I ask you to, Holy Spirit, I thank you that you're brooding over this place tonight. And Father, I ask you to give every person in this place an understanding to grab a hold of these things in Jesus' mighty name. You know what I do if I ever felt like you? You know what I do? I just bought a set of mine, Jesse K. de Mandela Pataradai. I pray in the Holy Ghost until everything in the atmosphere changes. Everything about my thinking changes. Everything about my emotions changes. Everything about my feeling, everything about the state of my existence changes until I have an encounter with the glory of the living God. I want you to try it. You will like it. Once you do get around to setting aside time so that all the glory of God might fill you, you're going to really like this. You're going to enjoy this. This is going to be exciting. It's going to be thrilling. It's going to be overwhelming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father stands ready to bless you. Father stands ready to pour out everything that belongs to him into your life, to energize you with and strengthen you and build you up and bless you. Why are you so busy? You don't have time to be blessed. Lord, why aren't you blessing me? Lord, why isn't this thing working out? Lord, why is it that I seem to labor for nothing? Lord, where is this glorious lightning bolt of heaven, this radiant brightness of the light of the gospel that's shining right now into my heart, giving me the knowledge of God, the awareness of your presence, the awareness of your will. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Just look at this quickly with me. Now, when you think about the privilege, when you think about it, no one could hear me. That's my problem. When you think about the privilege of being filled with the Spirit of the living God, overwhelmed with the glory of God, overwhelmed with the knowledge of the Lord. When you think about the privilege of having the visitations of heaven, how is it possible that you and I wouldn't give ourselves continually to having it, an explosion of that encounter that God so desperately awaits for us to have? And there's some people just say, well, it's just the sovereign moving of God. Hey, I'm talking about a sovereign moving of God that has already taken place. You can turn me up now so I don't have to hold it up there, okay? But you know what I can do also? I can grab this and help everybody. The Lord won't ask of us more than what we're able to do. Amen. Hallelujah. He won't ask of us more than what he empowers us with his glory to do. He won't allow us to be tested above what we're able. Amen. There's not a thing that you're going to go through tomorrow, not a challenge that you're going to go through tomorrow that Father hasn't seen that you're able to bear it. And you standing there in obedience to God is going to make the difference of how much glory of God is going to be allowed to flow through your life, how much hindrances are going to be allowed to remain in your life. Because to stand there in that place of being
tested and evaluated by the Lord, and you give yourself over to the assignments of Satan, you give yourself over to the word of darkness, I'm going to tell you right now, Satan is able to hinder that which God otherwise would be filling you up with. It's about time you quit trading in your riches for some empty paper bag.
Amen.
It's about time you quit giving up your glory for shame. It's about time. Did you understand the beauty and the splendor of heaven is made available to you, and how that these things begin to become real and activated and gloriously displayed as we begin to obey God and participate with Him?
Ha! Mandeira sutaya.
Now, I've got about 70% of the people. I still got some people who are aggravated, distracted, but that's okay. 70% of the people is pretty good. We can go somewhere now. Faith can begin to kick in. People don't understand how to fundamentally walk with God. They don't understand how to discern between the imaginations and the thoughts and the threatening things and as it were, the atmosphere that the enemy would try to create to shut you down. How to break through. Where are the strong men and the mighty men and women of God that no matter how much opposing force of darkness may stand against you, you know how to put it in its proper place. I mean, Jesus is manifested to destroy the works of the devil, and He wants to be manifested through you and me. A mighty anointing that breaks every yoke is something that is just is characteristic of who Jesus is in the ministry of Jesus. And these things, God wants to begin to reveal to our lives. Hallelujah. All you and I have to do is learn how to have no other choice but God.
Amen.
All you and I have to do is learn how to cooperate with no other one but Him. All you and I have to recognize is that there is this continuous, ongoing encounter of the presence of the Lord. How often can you look in the mirror? As often as you like. In fact, I encourage some people to just get themselves a compact mirror and carry it around with them and check in from time to time, make sure that the countenance of the Lord is still on them. The expressions of the Lord still on them rather than being overtaken with the sorrows of this world. Hello. I still think I'm hearing some snores in the back row. Jesus. I know I have to catch you guys on another night when you feel like revival. I have to catch you guys on another night when you're a little bit rusted up and you feel like a flow of the Holy Ghost could come. When there's a little bit more excitement in the air. I tell you right now, I got some excitement in the air for you right now. I'm telling you, the light of His glory is shining in this place right now. Woo! The beauty. Ha! 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 The beauty and the splendor of His glorious working power is present right here. Touch your life. Change everything about you. Jesus is in the house. Holy Ghost is in the house. Hey, the opportunity to have a gusting moving of His presence, of outpouring of His living water through your life. Right here, present, right in this moment. Right now. A deeper encounter with Jesus right now. A deeper revelation of the power of God present right now. Right now for you. Ida Bodosea. Ira baroseya mandeya rasura. Ira baroseya mamborositando lobore de shika. Man namon brezeya. Whatever the problem is, whatever the harassment is, whatever the torment is, whatever the threat is, in an instant, in a moment, it's dissolved like darkness is dissolved by the light. Hallelujah. The glorious gospel shining with the brightness of divine power and glory. The only way you're not seeing it is some part blindness at work, some influence, some distraction. I tell you, I believe that sometimes that some of the greatest breakthroughs take place in our life when the greatest hindrances rise up against us, but we won't be hindered. The greatest challenges come out against us, but we won't be threatened. Because we fixed. Our heart is fixed. Our trust is fixed in the Lord. We grab a hold of these things in God. We know who we are in Him. We have made our commitment to Him that we're going to come and we're going to dwell in Him and we're going to abide in Him, and I'm never going to dwell outside of Him, and I'm never going to be less than abiding in Him. And when He describes it, He's talking about a oneness. I'm never going to have less than that. And everything that I encounter in every circumstance in life has to measure up to that. It has to respond to that. And by and large, it really, most of the things just have to submit to it. It cancels out every lie of Satan. It cancels out every influence of darkness. Amen. Thank you, Father. So you begin to place a demand upon yourself where you begin to every day say, look, I'm going to be filled with the Spirit and begin to speak to myself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And it becomes a measure in your life every day. And when you look back on your day and you say, wait a minute. When I woke up this morning, I didn't say, Holy Spirit, I consecrate myself to you. Lead me, guide me. I want to be sensitive to you. I don't want to do anything outside of your will. I want to understand right now, Lord, how to be clothed with you, how to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to understand right now, Father, how to walk in the mind of Christ, how to let the Word of God live and dwell in me, be in the meditation of my heart, be the very thoughts of my soul and in my life. I want to understand, Holy Spirit, how to be sensitive to you so I live in you and move in you and walk in you and are led by you all day. Lord, I cannot even imagine that I would possibly run the risk of somehow ignoring you all day long. Well, to do that and not forget, you have to be hungry. You have to have an encounter enough with God that makes you hungry. Somebody said, well, it just causes me to not feel good about myself tonight, my relationship with the Lord, because I'm just listening to Him measure myself. I feel like I'm lost. My goodness, I don't have any hunger or thirst. No, don't have that attitude. So I'm going to get on my face and pray and cry out to God till I do have hunger. I'm going to cry out to God, the one who's promised to come and deliver me and help me if I find myself in any situation which I need to be saved from. He's come, promised to come and save me. Yes. I'm going to call out to Him, and I know that He will respond. Yeah. Some of you need to do that right now. Yeah. Lord, come and help me. I feel very human. I feel very natural. And it's really, you don't have to be on that negative side of things. Just simply say, Spirit of the Lord, rise up in me. Flow out of me. I mean, when you begin to become aware of what it means to be one whom Christ Jesus is revealed in, to be one who is manifesting the glory of the only begotten Son, then you're constantly going to be aware also of the measure of your joy and the measure of your love and the measure of your peace. And the measure of how you're recognizing the Holy Ghost, the measure of the anointing that is there right at your, you know, right at your fingertips, if you would. The mantle of heaven that is on you. It's just not good enough for you to live like you all day. It's just not good enough for you to be you. Somebody says, I'm a free spirit. I wouldn't be that if I were you. That's just an expression of something apart from the discipline and under the control and submission of the Holy Ghost. Oh, I just like spontaneity. Oh, you do, huh? You want to stop that real quick. I just like being spontaneous. Let's just stop that right now. Because that's just another expression of how you're in charge. It's about time you give place to the Holy Ghost and say, Lord, I don't want to do anything unless you want me to do it.
I want to learn. I want to come into your school and I want to learn how to be led by you. I want to learn how to walk with you. I want to learn how to be taught by you. I want to learn how to be filled up with you. I want to learn how to let your glory and your power be made manifest just in the things that I think that nobody else even gets to see. No one gets to see what you think by and large except for Father. But what happens when that becomes the most important activity of your life and most important thing in your life? Is it what Father hears and what Father thinks and what Father knows? Father, we just thank you for strengthening us. We thank you for building us up right now. We thank you, Father, for giving us the ability to lay hold on the inheritance that you have for us. We thank you, Father, that all the things that have distracted us, all the things that are earthly and natural and even carnal that we've been allowing ourselves to get involved in will become things that we despise, that we recognize them for what they are, and we don't allow ourselves to be caught up in that stuff anymore. Father, we just thank you that we can begin to be people that are so set apart unto you. Father, we want to display your glory. We want to display the beauty and the splendor of the fullness of your power now made available to those who've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Those who've been made a new creation by the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, we want to be those people who are conformed to your image. If you just begin to look at the glory, if you begin to just talk with Father and say, Father, what do you want me to look like? What do you want me to act like? What do you want me to do? I'll do whatever you want. Yeah. And then he begins to show you from his word exactly what that looks like. And you find yourself now being conformed to the image and say, okay, I want to be conformed to the image. How am I going to be conformed to the image? Look at the glory. What does the glory look like? The Son in you. Christ Jesus in you. You the temple of the Holy Ghost. Well, I don't feel like the temple of the Holy Ghost. Stop that right now. In Jesus' name. Because you went down the wrong road. And instead of getting carried away with your feelings and letting your feelings dictate to you or situations and circumstances or the things that the prince of the power of the air would impose upon you, you should say rather, oh God, arise. Oh Lord, let your glory begin to flow out of me. Father, I ask right now in Jesus' name, fill me with your joy. Fill me with your love. Fill me with your glory. Fill me with the overflow of heaven. Let those things of the Spirit begin to be expressed through me. I mean, the thing about it is the Lord has made it. It's so easy for every hindrance to be removed. There's no reason for hindrances to go on and exist. He's made it so easy for us to be able to regroup in him. Made it so easy for us to be able to find our footing in him. He's made it so easy for us to be able to discover a continual, ongoing, ever-increasing access into all that he has for us. Yep. We already have access anytime we want into his presence. And you know what? You should stay there. Amen. I've seen so many people that where they're so overwhelmed with doubt and unbelief, they don't believe that they know how to get into that glorious realm of the divine presence. And it's not imaginary. It is not religious. It is a divine reality, a miracle, a supernatural event. The Father wants us to begin to enjoy. It really is the place that we begin to behold things, our eyes are open, only in his presence to behold things as they really are, to look in the mirror and see the glory and there be changed into the image. There be conformed to the image. There to find everything about our life shaped, molded, adjusted, nurtured, matured, developed. To have a greater display of his power and a greater display of his glory and a greater display of his majesty. a greater activity of faith, a greater outworking of his gifts.
I believe people that are part of revival just always stay hungry, and you can't help but to always stay hungry when you realize the impact that if Jesus was to show up here tonight and begin to start his ministry tonight like he did 2,000 years ago, how that within a few short weeks, Southern California would be all gathered around and changed, because people are looking for the glory and the power of God to be made manifest. And when we look and we say, wait a minute, what's going on in our life? Then we have to recognize, Father wants to mature some folks. Father wants to cause an outworking of his spirit within our life through hunger and thirst to result in us laying hold on that which is made available to us. And then in that, enjoying our access that we have into his presence by his spirit, and not allowing doubt and unbelief and shame and discouragement to try to keep us out of that place, or to hold us back, or to have some just kind of, you know, casual interaction with God, some boring kind of prayer life. I mean, how many people would be touched by the power of God if they came and listened to you talk to Father in your prayer time? Just think about it. But when you make up your mind, when you determine that as you begin to talk to Father, as you begin to interact with him, you're going to stay right there until you find that place of the divine outpouring of his glory on you personally, to where every attitude and everything about your value system and everything about what you want or what you desire is now evaluated in the light of his presence. Because a lot of things that you decide to do throughout the course of the day were wrong decisions. A lot of and if there's never an evaluation of them, there's never an evaluation of them by the Holy Ghost, then they continue to exist in your life and grow and mature in your life, and you become something other than the revelation of Jesus. Something else is manifest through you other than the Son, the glory of the Son, the glory that the Holy Ghost himself displays.
So I'm going to try. I'm trying to get to another verse of Scripture here. Then I've got to read this one, because that just prompted me to another verse of Scripture, but I'm not going to go there until I read this one. This Scripture, the Lord God says this: quit bragging on yourself. Verse 3. Quit bragging on yourself. Huh? Quit being so overconfident and stubborn. Hallelujah. Huh? Quit being competitive. And that's what he says. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Let me go over there and read it. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. I just quoted it right. Praise God. My translation of that, quit bragging on yourself. Quit trying to convince everybody what you yourself aren't convinced of, how good you are, how well you do, how self-confident you are, whatever. You know what I'm saying? Quit doing that, because it's going to get in the way of what God the Holy Ghost would be. Quit being so self-confident. Quit being so competitive. Quit doing those things, because as long as you're doing that, you're all wrapped up in yourself, and all you're doing is keeping yourself from being able to enjoy all this beauty and all this glory that was manifested when Christ Jesus came and made you a new creation. You became a partaker of the divine nature, and the expressions of the Holy Ghost begin to be made manifest through every dimension of your life. In your demeanor, in your conduct, on your countenance, in the power and the authority of that which you said you had, the power of God, given the ability to command devils to do what you demand them to do, and they have to obey. You able to speak to the storms and the wind and the wave. You able to begin to move in the authority that was demonstrated in Christ Jesus, the only begotten Son. You begin to understand the authority of the Son. The authority of the Son was revealed in Jesus Christ when he spoke, and everything had to obey. The authority of the Son, the beauty of the Son, when he began to speak, when he began to act, when he began to move, heaven was revealed. When he came, glory came with him. Whoa, Basito Romani. I got about 80% of you now, man. We're moving up.
I got about 80% of you, and faith is rising because I got about 80% of you. Hallelujah. I got about 80% of the people in here beginning to get excited about the things of God, the Spirit of God. But you have to understand, you should have already been excited about the things of God before you came to the meeting. You should have let the enemy and circumstances and situations and run interference and begin to stop your joy. You should have let anything get in the way of the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit and the operation of the movings of God in your life, because otherwise you're going to find yourself in a state of neutral. You're going to be rolling down the hill backwards. It's awkward. It's scary too. Zopa. Limanda sikimbrasis. Zatane ekita ahapite haste. Bagrapisti adene. When God's people come to understand that Satan has no right to hinder them or influence them or stop them, that Father has given to us all of His provision and all of His glory, all we got to do is trust Him and walk over here in His love and let His word rule Him. I'm telling you, we'll mow down every power of darkness that exists in this side of the universe. I'm telling you, there'll be nothing that hinders the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every miracle, every display of the power of God, everything the Father has purposed for our lives will be realized in our life with an ever-increasing manifestation of His power and glory. There won't be the confused looks upon people's face. There won't be the captivated interest of things that have no value or meaning. And people give themselves to day in, day out for long hours. Let nothing to be done through strife and vainglory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But in lowliness of mind, let everybody begin to esteem everybody else better than themselves. Quit bragging on yourself. Quit running competition. Quit being, you know, self-confident, whatever. Come on, because it's gonna keep all that God has purposed to do. See, Jesus said, come and learn of me. He's called us to come and take His lowliness and meekness upon ourselves, because it begins to develop us into a place where we now know how to yield to the Holy Spirit and begin to receive those things that are freely given to us by God. I'm not just talking about a little flash in the pan, a little miracle revival for a couple of nights, a little moving of God the last 3 or 4 weeks. I'm talking about a place of an ever-increasing manifestation of the power and the glory, the splendor of the living God in our lives, where nothing can stop us. Amen. Nothing can hold us back. Every power that exists has to obey. Every sickness, every disease, every torment, every mind-blinding spirit. I mean, think about the heavenly vision. And when Paul talks about the glory of the gospel being hid by those, hidden from those whom the God of this world has blinded, and he, and within the framework of what he knows in God, and what the power of the Son that is to be revealed through his life could do by turning people from the power of Satan to the power of God. To be able to walk into people and say, I turn you right now from the power of Satan to the power of God. Yes. I give you over to the living God right now. Amen. From darkness to light you go now. Mm-hmm. No more will you walk in blindness. God's people need to start telling that, speaking to themselves over these things, kind of things. Amen. You need to start prophesying over yourselves. Just get in the mirror and start saying, in the name of Jesus. Until it becomes a change in thinking. A change in behavior. And to my wife, and you know, there's an equal submission here on this thing. Listen, if I begin to behave foolishly like I did last year, rudely correct me. I don't want to look nothing like I did last year. If I just continue to behave myself in some natural, human, carnal way that doesn't look like Christ Jesus and the power and the glory of the Son and the beauty of the Holy Ghost, then tell me with great harshness and holy indignation. Because I don't want it. I want to be rudely interrupted if I slip into such a backslidden state. I'm moving on in over into this realm of heaven to where that no action is an action less than that which the Holy Ghost produces. To live in the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ, what a privilege to be clothed with the glory of the Son. Listen, think about it, dear people with me. Come on now.
Don't make it worse. Come on now.
To be clothed.
To be clothed with the power and the majesty of Christ Jesus, to put on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
To be put on the Lord Jesus Christ is saying to be filled with the Spirit. Somebody said, I don't know how to be filled with the Spirit. You can't say that. How do you get filled with the Spirit? Are you ready? Ask. Open mouth and speak to God. Fill me.
Yeah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Here's one. Here's a great word you can learn, vocabulary word that you can learn that will result in you being filled with the Spirit. I thirst. Another one. Give me to drink. Are we with you? Getting this? Getting this?
Yeah. Yeah.
Write these down. I'm taking notes. I know this is deep. Hungry. There's a big word. He comes and fills everyone that is hungry. He will not send anyone who is hungry away empty.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You're looking so much better now. Praise God. This is the benefits of sitting on the front row.
Hallelujah.
And the Lord says, look not every man upon the things, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. In other words, don't be satisfied with what you have. Grab what everybody else has got too.
No, it doesn't say that. It says, don't be concerned about your needs. Be also concerned about everybody else's needs. I know that the former actually works more in people's lives. Don't be content with what you've got. Grab what everybody else has got as well. But that's not what the Lord is
for. I believe the Holy Ghost is laboring to break through.
I mean, to break through into whatever it is that you're in.
Hello.
And don't be concerned.
Hello, do I need to turn down? Can we hear back? Can you hear me back there? Was it? Did you not understand what was being said? Okay. Don't only be concerned about what you need of, and this is in every dimension, not just natural spirits as well, but also be concerned. It's sensitive towards what everybody else has needs of too, because you're esteeming them more important than you, and you come into this love of God where you're willing to lay down your life for everybody. Listen, it's the default program. God showed me over and over again, because I've said so many times, Lord, what on earth is wrong with so-and-so? What is their problem? And what the Lord just tell me, he says, well, this is why I told you to lay down your life for everybody. Well, Lord, I just need to tell them straight now, just lay down your life for them, because they won't get whatever you're going to say to them. They're not ready yet. They're not listening to me either, so don't feel bad. I mean, I hate the notion or the idea, the concept, which I know is a reality, and I don't want it to be a reality anymore, that there are many things that the Lord is saying to me that I won't listen to. And if I would just start listening, everything about that which Father has in the fullness of Christ Jesus and the manifestation of his glory would begin to flow out of me in a greater dimension. And I'm so desperate for it, I'm going to listen.
Yes.
And I'm not intimidated by that. I don't feel like, oh. I said to Miles' son today, he's just like the little guy, he's like sitting there going, I said, are you happy? He goes, yeah. I said, do you feel good? He said, yeah. I said, do you know that we love you? He goes, yeah. People, we just really don't want to live our lives like that. We don't want to be constantly, challenged with all of our issues and our problems and our defeats and our failures and all the stuff that everybody's saying about us. We got so much pressure to please everybody. But what a wonderful thing when we begin to just want to please God. What a wonderful thing when everything that he's said and all those things that he's declaring and that he's speaking to us doesn't become things that are overwhelming that make us feel unloved and unwanted and not doing it right. But rather, we hear it as a call and a cry of God. Come on up. Draw in. Come on in. Take a hold of all that I have for you. And it becomes an opportunity. It's not a rejection. It's an acceptance. Yeah. It's God dealing with us, loving on us so much. He wants us to have. He wants us to be a revival church. He wants us to be a part of the great moving and the great outpouring that He's purposed to take place in this earth right now. Father is laboring to bring something to pass. A relationship between you and Him that whatever you ask, He can do it. He's laboring to bring that to pass. That's what this whole thing is about tonight. He's laboring to bring this to pass. Father is earnest about all the oppressed going free. He needs some people that will begin to cooperate with Him, who will begin to hear from Him, who will begin to move in Him by His Spirit, not by your spirit, not by your power, not by your might, not by our ideas, not by our interests, not by our programs, but by that which He's designed, that the oppressed may go free, that the yokes may be broken off. You're just gonna have to understand that everything about your life has to radically change. Amen. Jesus Christ has come and demanded that everything about your life change. He wants to fill you with heaven. Amen. He's come to fill you with heaven. Yes. He's come to fill you with a divine glory that causes you to be so raptured, so apprehended, so taken hold of by Him. Paul said, I've suffered the loss of everything. And I count it all but dung that I might win Jesus for the excellency of the knowledge of the Lord. This is many years later, after the glory that raptured him and captivated him so much, he says, I just got to get away. I got to get away. I got to get along with the Lord. It's almost like he's driven out in the wilderness for 3 years. To be separated, isolated, to hear nothing else, to hear no one else's influences. 3 year fast. To receive an abundance of revelation about how God, who God has purposed you and me to be. And it all is going to begin with the way that we think. And the way that we think is going to be changed because now we give ourselves to hearing the Word. We give ourselves to listening to the Holy Spirit. Every time you hear the Word of God and you're willing to respond and obey, all of a sudden what's happening is you're now becoming sensitized to hear the Lord louder than you've ever heard Him before. The Lord wants to speak to you in ways that the wind that explodes the rocks cannot speak. He wants to speak to you in a way that the earthquake cannot speak. He wants to speak to you in a way that the fire, the all-consuming fire, cannot speak. He wants to speak in a still small voice and hear you respond. And usually he's going to be saying the same thing he said to Elijah in the still small voice. You know what he said? What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing now? Why are you here? Go get busy doing the work that I commissioned you to do. Quit complaining. Quit running in fear and hiding. Oh, Brabaseteki Mandasutoro no sia tapa. Le pekido mumbrusi preferi. Ushi primando pokurshi paratum. Listen to this. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be called one equal with God. Can you let that mind be in you? What? Yes. Huh? Yes. Could you let the reality that Father's called you up to be one with Him? Not equal with Him. Just one with Him. Not to think of equality with God as being something that could be comprehended. Christ Jesus truly was in every respect, if that measure then comes to bear, equal with God, not us, but one with him. To understand that the Spirit of the Lord is purposed to do such a work through our lives that there is an inseparable, indistinguishable glory going on in our life. To where that ultimately we even find ourselves in this amazing state where the scripture says, beloved, now are you the sons of God. And it does not yet appear what you should be, but we know that when we see him, we shall be like him. We shall see him as he is, for we shall be like him. An amazing, glorious gift of God where he's brought us into oneness with himself, where he says and he invites us, and the cry of God is, come dwell in me. And this is a place of oneness. This is a place of where of my thinking, recognizing, wait a minute, God is in me and I'm in him. I'm his tabernacle. I dwell in him. He dwells in me. This is what he's calling. He's calling us, come abide in me. Come dwell in me. Exist in me. Don't have any part of your being existing outside of me. Here's where you're going to bring forth fruit. That Father, the husbandman, is looking for. The fruit that he's designed and desired to have through our lives, expressed through our life. That whatever we ask, he will do it. Whatever we ask. This is the fruit. He ordained you. He called you. He chose you to bring forth this fruit. This is the fruit. The fruit that Father is waiting for, the ripe, manifest fruit that Father is waiting for, is displayed and seen in the person of Christ Jesus, in that relationship that he described. I say nothing except for what the Father speaks. Oh, how beautiful. How beautiful. Somebody said, oh, I would like to have that relationship. You may have it tonight, beginning tonight. The light of the glorious gospel of the knowledge of God is shining into your heart in the face of Jesus Christ right now. You can have it tonight. Here's what Father's saying. Speak it. Here's what Father's saying. Speak it. Here's what Father's saying. Speak it. Speak nothing except for what Father's saying. You can have it tonight. When Father sees somebody acting like that, when Father sees a people behaving themselves like that, when Father sees you living by the word, I'm going to tell you right now, his eyes are going to be upon you. His attention is going to be directed towards you. I know for a fact that what God saw in Paul was a relentlessness that as soon as he was touched by the fire of God, he was going to labor more than everybody else. Look at him go. Look how passionate he is about the law. I'm going to reveal the fullness of the law to him and come and show him how it's completed in me and watch how this man runs. So Paul said, the grace of God was not bestowed upon me in vain. The Lord didn't come to me and say, I purpose to reveal my son in you, and I just yawn and say, wow, that's great, wonderful, good, stoked, dude. He said, but I labored more than them all. But it wasn't me. It was the grace of God that was given me. He said, I am what I am by the grace of God. Here it is. Christ is at work on the inside of me. His word is at work in me. His word works effectual with the divine power of God. See, when I begin to take a hold of the word of God and speak the word of God, live out the word of God, and let the word of God rule my mind and my thinking, when it's my diet, when it rules my thoughts, and when it governs my desires and my passion, then the word of God is working with divine power, works effectually in me. Hallelujah. It's an engrafted word that is able to save my soul. It is the word that abides in me that it causes me to be able to overcome the wicked one. Hallelujah. It's the word of Christ that dwells in me richly, which allows me and empowers me to admonish. I'm always instant, in season, out of season. I've always got an anointed word that will strike and pierce the heart of those who hear me. Amen. Hallelujah. It's just there because I give myself to it. And I'm going to tell you right now, listen, I want you to hear me. You listen to me. Any time in my life, when the prayer begins, if the prayer is not active and fiery in my life on a daily basis, I notice a spiritual effect in my life. And I'm going to tell you right now, it is for you as well. It is for every one of us. The great men of faith, the people who displayed the power of God, even most recently. I'll just take Smith Wigglesworth, for example. A man who, once again, he was an ignorant guy. When it comes to academics, he couldn't even write his own name. His wife showed him how to do that. He couldn't read. He couldn't write. But he got grabbed hold of the power of God, and Father used him in an amazing way. And he said, I never prayed 15 minutes, but I never went 15 minutes without prayer. He was all about the authority of the Word of God. He says, listen, the man gave himself to memorizing the Word of God. He memorized the whole New Testament. He recognized that the authority of the faith and the power and the display of the Spirit of God was related to how much of the Word of God was in him. Listen to me, I'll ask you a question. How many of you read the Bible in the past 90 days? That's awesome. How many of you read the Bible in the past 5 years? You're too busy. Too much things going on. This is what I'm doing right now. It has a direct impact on Jesus being revealed in you, the living Word being revealed in you. Because what happens, it opens you wide open to a whole bunch of other lying, deceitful things that come subtly that otherwise would have been placed into check, because the Word of God is burning on the inside of you. The Word of God is fresh in your thinking and in your meditations. The words of your mouth and the meditations of your heart become acceptable unto Him, because His Word has placed in you. Your word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against you. The effectual working of the power of the Word of God, it has an impact on you. That's why Prophet Roger Teal's words is really resounding, powerful. Read your Bible, say your prayers, and be good. True. It really isn't that much more, it isn't that any more difficult than that. But it's more than just religiously reading the Bible. It's taking a hold of the living Word. Huh? It's feasting on the Word. Hallelujah. I praise God for my wife. We've got Bibles open all over the place. Huh? There's one sitting there on the counter in the kitchen. I can walk by. I can just check. Spot reading. Oh, powerful. Then go into the bedroom. There's another Bible open. Okay, there's another passage. Okay. I can go walk towards the bathroom. There's another Bible open. There's another passage. Says, man, where you go? There's a Bible open. She's reading something. It's highlighted. And it's marked what you highlight today. And it becomes to you spiritual food, and you can feel the same kind of results in your spirit. You can see, you can feel the same kind of impact. You can feel a holy glow begin to come upon you.
Yeah.
You can begin to be strengthened. Just the same kind of impact you feel physically begins to happen in your life spirit. You know, my wife makes me this amazing juice. It's like this carrot juice with beets in it and whatnot. And you drink that thing and you're like, poof. I mean, I get these drinks in the morning that is like cranberries and lemon and orange juice. Wah! I mean, I am just, my body is just so quick. I'm like, I'm ready to run. The thing about it is, there's something that's even more profound in the realms of the Spirit. And I'm afraid that many people have not tasted these things. I'm afraid that many of you have only tasted them here tonight, just in part, in a small dimension, and you've never allowed that to grow and increase. Thus Christ Jesus, the man Christ Jesus, the person Christ Jesus, the living Word on the inside of you, can't really truly be revealed because you're distracted and preoccupied with other words. You're under the mandate and under the rulership of other influences. Hear me. Born of the Spirit, made partakers of the glory, made partakers of the heavenly vision, made partakers of the divine nature, but distracted under the influences of other things and other words and other spirits and other situations and other interests. Hear me. Hear me now. There's only one power that can, listen, there's only one power that can deliver you from this. There's only one way. You must take heed unto your soul and begin to live by the Word. You must take heed unto your soul and begin to live by the Spirit. You gotta come to recognize in Jesus' mighty name the difference between the spirit of the world and the Spirit of God. That fundamentally right there, I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. If you would do that, the majority of things that have hindered your life, the majority of things that have stolen your joy and affected your love and the display of Jesus Christ in your life would be shut down just because of one area of discernment, one area of understanding, one area of the knowledge of God to be able to discern between that which is of the Spirit of God and that which is the spirit of the world, because it's convoluted, it's mixed. Believe me. It's mixed. And that's why the Spirit of the Lord labors all the time talking about these things. And some of you, I watch your responses, because if there's any place where the enemy has an authority to mix it in your life, you'll begin to draw back. You take offense at the Word of God. Don't ever take offense at the Word of God. Don't allow yourself to be offended by the Word of God. Amen. Allow yourself to be filled with joy and excitement over the Word of God. Yeah. Being offended by the Word of God is a terrible manifestation. Amen. Huh? Being upset, because I know how to get radical with hindering spirits that would try to oppose the Word of God, is, and to have a disposition that there's something wrong with that, there's something wrong with you. There's not something wrong with someone who wants to run off every influence of hell. You understand me? Yeah. To not discern that is a mixture. It's a mixture. Huh? Somebody said, well, you know, I have a problem with it because I had, you know, an abusive father. It has nothing to do with anything about the Spirit of God. What's your problem? It's a mixture. Now you're mixing the spirit of the world with the Spirit of God. You see that? Because you're talking about how your abusive father has some kind of impact on the manifestation of the Spirit of God. You listening to me? Yes. It goes on. I can continue. I want to see you come out from these things, these influences, these impacts. I want you to be able to recognize that when you allow the spirit of fear, that at that moment in time, the spirit of power is shut down in your life. You listen to me. I want you to understand, when the spirit of bondage, when fear begins to work, the spirit of the Son is shut down. The spirit of the Son knows and believes the love that God has for us. God is love. Herein is our love made perfect. What will perfect love do for you? Cast out all fear. He that fears not made perfect. He that fears is not made perfect in love. Did you know that? You know how you're going to be made perfect in love? You say, oh God, I want to be made perfect in love. Well, then don't believe the love that God has for you. Let the light of the glorious gospel shine into your heart with the knowledge of God and the very face of Jesus staring right at you. Burning up your eyeballs. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kena mandukia. Monkadia moshikania. You know, Father raises up shepherds for revival. And that what that looks like is somebody who shows God's people how to distinguish between the filthy and the holy, to discern between the good and the evil, the profane and that which belongs to God, the spirit of the world and the spirit of God, the spirit of the Son, the spirit of bondage, the spirit of fear and the spirit of power and love. Now I'm even going to get upset about it. You're not going to get upset about it. I'll tell you right now, you're going to get in trouble. Papa get his belt out. And then they can look good. And we're all, you know, when Papa gets his belt out, all the rest of the kids are standing back going, oh. Feeling bad for you. He paturi masiti atunana. He paturo no mositi anamotorishia. I mean, really, let this mind be in Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Quit bragging on yourself. Start bragging on God. Quit depending upon yourself. Depend upon God. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Know who you are in God. Know what God's purposed you to be. He knew who he was. He knew he was the only begotten Son. We're not the only begotten Son, but we sons in the only begotten Son. Hallelujah. We're given the same glory, the same power, the same baptism, same cup to drink. Same inheritance. There's such boldness in this, people. There's such boldness. Grabbing all these things, such boldness in it. Yeah. You can wake me up in the middle of the night, we'll get somebody healed. You wake me up in the middle of the night, we'll go, we'll cast out devils. You can get me when I'm so tired I can barely hold my eyes open, we'll see heaven move. Amen. Hallelujah. Whew. You can catch me in a place off guard and I'm going to check my attitudes by laying down my life. I'm going to live by a principle. I'm going to lay down my life. I'm going to give myself for the brethren. I'm going to lay down my life. I'm not going to speak evil to anyone. I'm just going to lay down my life. There's times that the Lord knows I pour out my complaint. Father, why? What on earth? When do people grow up? 80? 110? When, Father, do people quit being selfish and start being concerned about others? I mean, you know, I'll do that, and then I'll say, oh, forgive me.
Father, I said, I'm going to lay down my life with the brethren. I'm walking in love as you show me how to walk in love. What am I doing now? I'm cooperating with the Holy Ghost. And then right in the midst of that, I say, Spirit of the Lord, fill me with your love. Let your love overwhelm me right now. Let your power and your glory overwhelm me. I'm going to tell you, I was up on the platform here tonight going, oh, God, move in this place right now. Lord, unless you come and move by your Spirit. I didn't know I had my microphone on. So it was going out over the, over the web. God bless you move in this place. It's going to be just another meeting. It's not going to be a good one. You can always count on the Word of God and the Spirit of God. All you got to do is whatever situation you're in, start hitting it with the hammer of the Word. Yeah. Huh? Don't let up till things change. I tell you right now. All you got to do, no matter what you're in, is start hitting it with the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Don't let up till everything changes. Don't walk away because you feel a hindrance. Knock it out. Knock it out. Deal with it. Confront it. Hallelujah. We're up to about 95% of the people gathered together now. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, we just got to get past this place of coming in with all the stuff. Huh? We need to understand how to come up ready, waiting on our ministry, filled with the Spirit, filled with the things of God. Hallelujah. Overwhelmed, overflowing with the rivers of heaven. Where the atmosphere of faith is able to supercharge the atmosphere, because you hooked up with what God the Holy Ghost is doing. Hallelujah. You know what, tonight, wouldn't you just love it if you never felt bad about yourself ever again? If you never evaluated yourself ever again? If you just let your life be hid in Christ Jesus and say, Lord, you've done all things well. Lord Jesus, you are amazing. I'm in you and you in me. Woo! I mean, think about it. I tell you right now, self thing, I mean, whoever wants to be in it anyways? I mean, it's nothing but a bunch of burden and problem and stress and sleepless nights and worry. Come on. When all the time you could be hid in Christ Jesus and not care no more. Because everything's good in him. You just see the beauty of the sun. All you know, you're in him. everything's good. Everything's good. Everything's good. Everything's good. And getting better. Everything's great. And going over the top. Woo, this is a great week. Dee and Summy getting married. I just love the workings of God. I like looking at the workings of God. I want to look at the workings of God in your life. Amen. I want to see the movings of God in your spirit. You know why you want to cooperate, though? You're going to have to get happy. Yeah. You're going to have to either get happy or prophesy. Whichever one you in the department right now to do. Get happy or prophesy. Huh? Get in a place of where you're cooperating with the Holy Ghost. You just always recognize, what am I doing? You say to yourself, what am I doing right now? What am I thinking about right now? I thought, you know, all kinds of assailing thoughts going to come against you. Satan is going to do everything he possibly can do to make his fiery darts hit the mark. That's why you need to be strong in the Lord and strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. The only way that's going to happen is that you're going to be willing to be filled with the Spirit. And you can't some default say, I was baptized in the Holy Ghost 50 years ago. Because that don't mean nothing. We're talking about something that's actively you participate with, being filled continually with the Spirit. And I know it's being filled continually with the Spirit, not only because of the Greek context and the language and the verbiage that is used there, but because God says, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, and you and I are given, we're created to continually praise and to continually give thanks. Hallelujah. Continually offer up this kind of worship. This is worship. That's worship by the Holy Ghost. A friend of mine tweeted the other day, said, I think the more people are interested in writing song to become a number one hit rather than to boast in God and praise and worship him. And I liked it. I said, that's true. You don't have a lot of people that is just devoted to being a psalmist, to boast in the Lord, worship God, and magnify his holy name. Hallelujah. To receive God in the monkey's day.
You have people around here that are like that. We like they're dedicated to being a psalmist and worshiping God and magnifying and praising His holy name. And we want you to be that dedicated to being a psalmist and worshiping God and praising and honoring Him, glorifying Him. If your praise is sick, we want it to be healed tonight. If your joy and rejoicing is sick tonight, we want it to be healed tonight. We want it to be made perfectly whole so you can rise up from this place and go shine with the brightness of the glory of the sun so the Father can have His boast in that which He's willed for your life, to reveal His Son in you. Amen. To reveal the full glory of Christ Jesus, the person of the resurrected, exalted, living God manifested in you right now. Amen. The person of Jesus Christ. If you quit looking on things that belong to your natural ability and be captivated by what God has given to you as a free gift, the whole dimensions of what you're able to do in God changes overnight. Overnight. Believe me. Look at this verse of Scripture quickly with me. In 1 John. Are you thirsty?
Yes.
Have a drink. Have a drink. Have a drink. Have a drink. So I said, well, how do I have a drink? It's real simple. It is a little bit more than open up your mouth and swallow. It is a little bit more than open up your mouth and swallow. You ask, give me the drink. Give me the drink. Lord, give me the drink. And then you begin to drink. You begin to drink of what? You begin to drink of His goodness. You begin to drink of His salvation. You begin to drink of His love. Begin to drink of all the wonderful things that He's done for you. Begin to acknowledge God. You begin to acknowledge every good thing that is on the inside of you. You begin to let your faith become effectual. It becomes filled with divine power because you begin to acknowledge every good thing that is on the inside of you. What God has done, you begin to make your boast in the Lord. That's praise. To make your boast in the Lord. To brag on God. You listen to me. To brag on God, that's praise. Hallelujah. To brag on God, that's praise. Hallelujah. To give thanks to God is to begin to rejoice in all the wonderful things that you're bragging about is now coming to you. One of the things that you're bragging about what God does, He's doing it for you. He's doing it towards you. Jesus, you're amazing. 1 John chapter 3, verse 24 tells us this. He says this. And it's the interaction, it's an obedience. Jesus, see, there's a, he that dwells in love dwells in God. And understanding that dwelling in this love of God is this, not that we love God, but that He loved us. And so I can dwell in that love that He's loved towards me. Now He says, I want you to reciprocate that. He says, if you love me, you'll obey me. I love you. And praise God that He does. And He continues to fill us with His love by the Holy Ghost. But now He says to us, if there's going to be a relationship here, if you're going to be in a position now to receive me from me and be taught by me and to be developed by me and to be raised up by me, then you have to obey me. And so we hear in the Scripture it says, and he that keeps His commandments dwells in Him. Now I want to just tell you what His commandment is here in this perspective. His commandment is this, come dwell in me. His commandment is come dwell in me and love one another and walk in love. That's His commandment. And primarily, it's the bigger focus of what John is talking about, of us walking in love. Of course, you walk in love, and this kind of love, you fulfill all the law and the prophets anyways. Amen. You find yourself having every dimension of the divine nature being expressed through your life. He says this. He says, and hereby we know that He abides in us. So it's an invitation. See this? There is an invitation for us to come dwell in Him. And then there is a declaration and an evidence an act outworking by which we understand that he abides in me, that he abides in us. How does he abide in us? By the Holy Spirit, by the Spirit that he's given to us. So Christ Jesus dwells in me. He's purposed that his son be revealed through me. Why? He's reproduced his son in me by the new creation, this new birth. Jesus said, unless a grain of wheat fall in the ground and die, it abides alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. And he was talking about the life that he was about ready to lay to sow into, as a seed. And the fruit that came forth is you and me, and the seed reproduces after its own kind. And then Father goes ahead and emphasizes that with greater force as he describes to us the miracle of oneness, as Jesus describes the miracle of oneness to us that we have with him in John 14, 15, 16, and 17. A miracle of oneness that is a display in our lives because we participate with the Holy Ghost. A miracle that is displayed in our lives because you and I, do you understand how to participate with the Holy Ghost?
Amen. Thank you, Holy
Spirit. Do you understand how to participate with the Holy Spirit right now? Do you know how to receive what he has for you? Do you know how to take a hold of his word right now and it expunge everything that is contrary to God in your life?
Yeah.
His
Amen.
Word will take and expunge, erase, do away with everything contrary to what he's declared.
Yeah.
In your life right now. Poverty, expunged. Fear, erased. Condemnation, no more. Shame, gone. Doubt, unbelief, out the door. Light shines, darkness goes. All the time we're interacting with the Lord Jesus, he's asking us a question. Do you believe that I'm able to do it? We come to him with our needs, like the blind man. Lord, that I may receive my sight. We come to him with our needs, and he responds to us just like he does the blind man. Do you believe I'm able to do it? Yes, Lord. According to your faith, be made whole. Be it unto you. He's always going to say, do you know who I am? You believe I'm able to do it? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. See, told Ramon to say it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now, Elizabeth, how's your body doing? Huh? Is this thing completely and totally healed? Is it healed? Is it healed right now? Is it healed? Any more ill effects from it? Anything been happening recently? Today, in Jesus'
yes.
name,
yes.
right now in the name of Jesus, I speak to this gland in your body, and I command it to obey the word of the living God right now in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus Christ, obey me now in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Socorro stebana ne pata la citas. Membrestest taromos. Mendeste prevetus chevredecis tibi andotai. Torose revecis ti andolos. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Sutara masateya mokaya la masata. Eresti paranosta vrede. Monglesti paranaya. I command these torn muscles in Jesus' name. Be healed. Be healed in Jesus' name right now by the power of God. In Jesus' name. Molose rinaya. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody, would you stand with me? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. All we have to do is be willing to be led by the Holy Ghost. Be willing to let the Holy Spirit have first place in our life. Simply by being filled with the Spirit. Huh. You filled with the Spirit, you've got all the protection of God. You've got the whole armor of God. You've got everything the Father has. It belongs to you. Now, that's not hard. That's God's design. That's not hard to do. That's not hard to have. That's not something you got to go look for and search for and try to find somewhere. By some special deeds, good works. This is God's program. This is covenant. This is what He's planned for you to have. The biggest challenge is that you don't understand the discernment. You don't discern between the spirit of the world and the spirit of the Lord. You can't be receiving another spirit and the influence of another spirit. You've got to grow up enough to shut that down and say, wait a minute. I'm not going to give my emotions and my behaviors and my thoughts and my actions to respond to any dimension of the spirit of the world. And the contrast between the Spirit of God and the Spirit of the world is made very, very plain by the Word of God first and foremost. And then as we begin to step into a greater outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Paul said something so profound that we've got to grab a hold of in Galatians chapter 1, 15 and 16. God purposed to reveal His Son in me that I might preach Him among the nations or proclaim Him among the nations. Which then causes us to understand that that's the result of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Because the Lord says, you can't be my witnesses. You can't go proclaim my name to the nations. He said, go you all in the world and preach the gospel. But first, wait for the promise of the Father. Because you'll be endued with power from on high. Son, I want you to step right in, otherwise you're just going to change my flow. Just step in and do something, because otherwise you can't. You got to know what you're doing or don't do anything at all. I'm very focused on going somewhere tonight and having a result here tonight and very challenged by a lot of opposition. But there's more with us than are with them. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Spekiatu shimando bokura nasete iste petust. E predam bruste ki predastu talana mexti kesti braste dara bekisti. Mando de beking brasata talana mek este. Ebre mati premet isisus. Tonight, we want God, the Holy Ghost, to evaluate every dimension of our attitudes, the things that we've said and the acts and the deeds that we've done. And anything that is not according to His Word and not according to the activity of the Holy Ghost, we want it out of our life, and it goes out of our life through repentance. It goes out of our life through calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and taking the blood of Jesus Christ and applying it to our life and then saying, Lord, I thank You not only for Your forgiveness, but rather also that You empower me with the Holy Spirit to do it Your way, to be able to walk in wisdom and insight, to be able to walk in the spirit of wisdom and revelation, to walk in the knowledge of the Lord, to see things, Father, as You see them, to understand them as You understand them, to no longer be blinded in part or blinded at all by the God of this world, the spirit that works in the children of disobedience, that which opposes the anointing and opposes everything that God would do. Hallelujah. The spirit of the fire of God is here right now. Listen, I'm telling you right now, the power and the glory of the Holy Ghost is here to touch you right now. I feel an overwhelming activity of the Holy Ghost. To bring, not to rekindle something that you already have, but to bring a whole new dimension of newness in Him. Of growth and maturity in Him. I want you to receive. I want you to take a hold of that which God would do
because you're willing to believe and recognize that Jesus Christ is here. And that what we're saying is absolutely true. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The healing power of Christ Jesus is here right now. If you're watching by the web, the healing power of Jesus Christ is touching you right now where you're seated, right now where you're standing. If you're watching by YouTube, the power of God is present right before you right now. He touches you. He reaches out to you. You can feel His presence right there, right now. Don't any person let doubt and fear fill your heart as though somehow you separated from God, somehow you're far away from His touch, somehow you aloof or distant from Him, because He's a present God. He's a living God who's present right here, right now to touch you, no matter what your need is. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the glory of God, let the glory of God, let the knowledge of His glory fill you. Let the power of the glory of His only begotten Son now overwhelm your heart and overwhelm your life. Let this identity which Christ Jesus has given us, let this wonderful work of the Spirit of the Lord begin to produce fruit in you. Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we ask You to use us in a greater way. Father, we ask You to use us in a greater way. Robo se deve di ganja de besta vedefre danosi. Father, we ask You to use us in a greater way. Mambrova de vestiki di mambra batasale. Hallelujah. Mambrova besta zi dambra bast. Father, we ask You to use us in a greater way. Ha. Father, we reach to You right now for Your divine grace to begin to move upon our lives in a way that we can participate with You, Father, in the things that You desired us to step into. Jesus.
Jesus. Rabba basiki brevenamba de se patuya. Ivre betasa ramonga de vidi balando boroso toya.
Lord, we thank You for Your great outpouring.
Ha. Haribeste brenande bedi velasto dolomo.
Father, we thank You for this baptism of heaven upon our lives. We thank You, Father, that You purpose to reveal Your Son in us. Father, we thank You for the glory of the only begotten Son, for the glory of Your presence, for the glory of Your Spirit here resident in our lives right now. We thank You, Father, for the fullness of the expression of Your love and of Your glory and of Your power. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus. Jesus. Lord, I want everything about my life. I want everything about my life changed right now. I want everything about my expressions to grow and mature and to be a greater display of Your power, a greater expression of those things that belong to heaven. Jesus. Jesus, mambra na zoze, mambrum da jazune ze, mambrum da zoze ne be, mambrum da zoze de bekesu, mambrum da zabora sekita bukanea pakanea shika bonda darnai, ebre besebe de bo lidan beste brust, Thank you, this dear Ramon Jesilicano Shipayo. Eristaran, Eristane Moronde in Berendaya. Hallelujah. 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 Brongere Nambongele Kikata Soroto Rivita Parara Sita Rotoyes. Ivreveta Fadora Seteri. Manananananjay. Nananjene Mangu Suru Nosis. Araba Bere Bende Kere Monges is the Rushi Dena Mangalea. Oh, Papa Baba Zebre. Apa Babra Baba Basa Dere Deshi Kurazish. Ha. Mandebre Mane Berine. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your signs and wonders, for the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Thank you, Lord, for your working of miracles, for your gifts of healing. Father, we thank you for the discerning of spirits, for the working of miracles. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The gifts of healing. Hallelujah. We thank you for the gift of faith, Father. We thank you for prophecy and tongues and interpretation of tongues. We thank you for the great outpouring of your spirit through our lives. We thank you for this great communion that you've given us with yourself. This great fellowship that we have with you and in you. Jesus. 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 Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Rabba barasteyat. Labrabba babasteyat. Now, Father, you see tonight that there's places in people's lives that you've not had access to. Father, we pray tonight that that changes. Father, there's people in this place tonight who've had sickness and diseases way too long. Lord, we know that you purpose to heal every single person, that there's not one that you say no to. Lord, we ask you and thank you right now for doing a work that causes that whatever it is that's hindered to be removed out of the way. Right now in Jesus' name. Jesus. Jesus. Iraposu torinica monosita. Iraposu cara masete remenge le sepatoro sust. Iraposu tara venest. Mandele desis. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Probo sukurinipa. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Baro Soto Renepa. Thank you, living God. Toro Siri Vazuranamba de Podost. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Father, for your glory now. 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 Thank you, Father, for the great outpourings of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you that you set our tongues as a pin of a ready rider.
Yes,
as a quill in your hand to write out the things, oh God, to speak out the things, oh God, that is in your heart to speak not only to ourselves but to all mankind around us. Thank you, Father God, for this great display of the Holy Ghost. Father, thank you for this great manifestation of the only begotten Son through our lives. Thank you, Father, for a revival that shakes first and foremost each individual in this place. That shakes this church and the churches of America. That shakes the city and the region and the state. And the nation. Father, number the people in this place tonight an account of God. That there are these many people that are willing to lay down their life. That there are these many people, oh God, that are willing to live in the glory of your salvation and the revelation of your only begotten Son. That are willing to live and walk out the very life of the Holy Ghost. They're willing to live and walk out the very life of the person Jesus Christ. To walk in the power, to walk in the authority, to walk in the knowledge, to walk in the relationship. To walk in the discipline, to walk in the obedience, to walk in the servitude and the submission of the Son. To walk in the emptying of our own self and our own desires and our own thoughts and our own wishes and our own mind. To have your manifest will be all that we participate with. That dictates our lives, the disposition of our body, our physical existence. That rules us with your divine health and divine healing. That rules us with the knowledge of the Lord, ruling our mind and conducting our conversation aright. That rules us in boldness. That rules us in authority and confidence. That rules us as those who are standing in your place, in your stead, doing your work, executing your judgments in the earth. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And then, Lord, we ask you in your mercy and your grace to strengthen those, Father, that have started out but never been willing to continue on. Those who started out in a prayer life and being committed every day to touch in the realms of heaven, but allow distractions. Tonight, Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll show them not a place of discipline and place of a religious commitment, but a place of intimacy and a place of relationship, a place of friendship, a place of being empowered, a place of being filled up, a place of being receiving that which you have to give. A place of thanksgiving and praise, a place of bragging on you, making their boast in you. Father, I ask you now in your grace, lay hold on me. Lay hold on the people in this place. Lay hold, oh God, and grab a hold of us in such a way that we compelled and apprehended by you. Hallelujah. Father, in your loving kindness and tender mercies, Lord, I ask you this, as it were, put a special kind of bracelet, a special kind of gifting, a special kind of token and as it were, apparel upon your servants here tonight in your mercy, that the things that Satan has done to beat him up and to overwhelm him and overcome him and distract him will not be able to run their ruin anymore and work against them effectively. That they'll be able to begin to be that much more confident in your outworking of your power, and they won't be overwhelmed by the lies of the enemy tries to berate them and tries to strip them of your love and of your glory and of your anointing that you've given. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm just telling you right now, we're about to go somewhere in a minute. We're about to just cross over the threshold. You're about to cross over the threshold of the natural into the supernatural, of the ordinary and the common into the things that only belong to heaven. Just be so strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. Be so built up in God. It doesn't matter what happens, you're excited about God. Hallelujah. I ain't a munger, is it? Thank you, Jesus. Tonight, the sobering reality of God will bring a change that you will not even be able, as it were, to measure yourself. You'll not even be able, as it were, to even tolerate and be comfortable with the things that have been in your life and the expressions of the Holy Ghost that have been in your life up to this point. That you'd be so given over into a realm of divine power and glory, so captivated by the beauty of the sun, so captivated by the glory of the Spirit, so captivated by the things of heaven, that you come into a place where it can't be measured. It can't be measured. It can't be reckoned. It's so different. It's so new. You won't even be able to, as it were, handle the same sound. You won't be able to even handle, as it were, the same dimension of praise. Because see, this is what God does. God brings us to a place to where that which we have been excited about and has been his move and has been a refresh in our life becomes something that it's now time to move on for God has deeper things. He's got greater manifestation of what it means to praise. Greater manifestation of what it means to have a functioning flow of the anointing of the Holy Spirit called tongues of fire. Greater, it's greater. It don't even sound the same. No, I said it don't even sound the same. I said it don't even sound the same. It's deeper now. There is a place of consecration and commitment that takes place tonight in your life. To where that the call to the Word of God and to feast upon the things of the Word of God, to have that which God would ignite in your spirit that only will take place through the communion with His Word will become something that you cannot live without. That prayer will be a living communion that goes beyond the things that you've had up to this point, where literally as you begin to talk with Father, the atmosphere changes, you're overwhelmed, you feel the mantle of heaven come upon you. Neither do you feel the delight that belongs to the sons of God, that does who walk in the things of the Spirit. Tonight, by the grace of God, you step into a place of finding a boldness and faith to where you don't wait many days to see the thing come to pass that you've asked for, that you proclaim, or that you've spoken. But it happens quickly. You find yourself being less in your participation with what you can do with your own ability and with your own strength. And more determined to stand still and see and behold the power of God. The workings of the Spirit. This is the change that God demands. This is the change of going from glory to glory. This is the change that happens as the grace of God is allowed to move in our lives by the Spirit of the Lord. The Holy Ghost, who brings freely all those things that Father has given. Yes. And we see and we behold that which He's spoken in His Word and understand it to be that which we can have right now, not later, but now. It's ours now. Recognizing that Father labors over His Word. He broods over His Word. He watches over His Word. To bring it to pass, He's forever settled it in heaven, and He watches over His Word to bring it to pass in your life. The things which He has declared, He's anxiously waiting to see fully developed and revealed. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Tonight, you're able to step into a place with God where you recognize it's the grace of God that brings change. That you do not have to look to yourself to bring the change, to bring the increase, to bring the maturity, to bring a greater expression of the flow of the Holy Ghost. But you can look to the Father who you have committed to wait upon continually. Jesus. Tiato inabado manist. Tiato. Tiato dono manisitan. Tiaramo siti anamo sitara bupra. Bokina manjestu toromositiki. Jesus. Soto rito si tambu de ramos. Now, it's one thing for me to lay my hands on someone and say you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. But it's altogether a different thing when Father Himself declares from His own mouth, I've blessed you with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. Now, you listen to me. The men of God that have been used by God, even we see it in Christ Jesus' life, it became imperative that people would be willing to believe that those things which were spoken by the man of God would surely come to pass. They would have to believe that that person, that man of God, was sent from God. And if they would believe that that person, that man of God, was sent from God, then they would receive the miracle for which they desired. So even more it is essential for you to believe those things which God has declared in His Word. That He has the power to bring it to pass, and that He is devoted to bringing it to pass in your life. And should you believe it, should you say, yes, that is true, that is what God has done for me, then those things will become immediately a miraculous reality to you. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Now, I want to pray for anyone who wants prayer. Tonight, if you're standing in this place and you've never given your life over to Jesus Christ, if you're uncertain as to whether or not your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, tonight you can know for certain, because God will do such a work by Christ Jesus that you will have a certainty of who you are in Him. If there's any power of oppression or fear or terror reigning in your life where you feel distant from God, Father wants to cure that tonight, that demonic power can work no more against you, that those lies of hell can no longer separate you. Wolves are always trying to separate sheep from the shepherd. Praise God, we got a good shepherd. Father watches over us. He's amazing. What a good shepherd. His watchfulness, His watchful eye. You know, the Lord just allowed me to experience some of this, you know, doing the things that we're doing, to where it just seems like I'm always set up for it. Because I'll look out and I'll look out across the pasture and the fields, and it's almost like I can almost count everybody that is out there without even counting them. I just know whether everybody's there or not. And the Lord always sets me up this way, and I think He does so just simply so that I can just become that much more aware of His watchfulness, of His watchful eye, be that much more of a participant in His shepherdship. But it's like the other day, I was walking by, just doing some things. I looked out across the field about a mile away. Half a mile to a mile away, I saw a coyote way out in the field. And it's like almost like he was magnified, and I could see that his ears were perked out. I could see that he was perked up, and I could see that he was looking at something. Immediately, I scanned over, and I counted all the calves that were way out in the distance. There was one missing. I said, I know what's going on. The coyote's running down a calf. So I take off. Good looking, searching. The mother cow is looking for the calf, moving. The other mother cows come along, they help. That's what they do. They're moving, they're searching. They can't find the baby. The baby calf is hiding from the coyote, the predator. They're moving. I'm watching, I'm staying and back in the tree line so that I don't disturb anybody. Just watching them, because who better find the baby than the mom? Her sense of smell, her keenness to the environment. Just watching. She can't find the baby. So I head out across the field, walking. She still can't find the baby. And then I just go walking down the line, and finally I discovered the baby. Hiding away, tucked in a little hollow so that the coyote can't find it, mama can't find it. I stare at the baby. Of course, mom comes around and gets the baby. The watchful eye of the shepherd. You ain't gonna drift far. You ain't gonna disappear. And his watchful eye not come looking for you. Not come searching and seeking you. God's always on time for you. There's no reason for you to feel alienated, separated from God over anything. Those of you husbands and wives, you're still having controversy and arguments in your home, you got to shut that down. You're both wrong. You're both wrong. You got to shut it down. You're both wrong. I said shut it down in Jesus' name. Shut it down. God's called you to walk in love, not strife. Walk in agreement, rather, not strife. And I've discovered that if people just start praying in the Holy Ghost instead of trying to talk it through, just start praying in the Holy Ghost. Just shut it down. Just start praying in the Holy Ghost. And it turns out just perfect. Hallelujah. Turns out perfect. Peace sets in, and goodness and mercy follows you and blesses you. It's wonderful. It's a good thing to think the goodness and mercy. Goodness, that means the favor of God, the blessings of God. Goodness is what passed over Moses. You understand? He said, I cause all my goodness to pass over you. Hallelujah. If you're going to walk around saying, well, badness is just badness. I don't know what's wrong with me. You know what's the problem? When you walk around saying, I don't know what's wrong with me. You haven't taken time to talk about what's right with him. It's the doubt, the unbelief, the thinking after the manner of men is going to have to cease in your life. And nobody can stop it but you. I'd like to walk around with you and go, no, that thought's wrong too. Don't have that one. No, that one's wrong. No, that one too. That one. Oh. Here, let me get the word out. Say this after you say, read this. But I can't. But you know who is? Someone far more effective than me. Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm going to leave it there. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody feel like they're hiding from the wolves right now? All alone. Predators are on you. Don't worry, Christ Jesus is fast on your trail. The Good Shepherd is there. I want everybody to stand with me because I just want to say this one thing to you in closing. The things that God has asked of us and required of us is very easy to step into and have. It's very easy to step into and have. The only reason that we don't have them or we have less than what God would have us to have is because we aren't willing to let His Word dominate us. And then by and large, we're not. His Word can't dominate us because we're rarely in His Word. So let that be changed tonight. Our hearts are overwhelmed only because, with other things, only because we're not allowing the Spirit of the Lord come fill us. What happens when you filled? What happens when you filled? When you filled, there's not room for anything else. You filled. I'm full. Would you like dessert? No, I'm full. I can't. There's not any more room for anything else. When you get filled with the Spirit, all this other stuff comes along. It's like, well, I don't have time for that. I've no room for it. I have no room for being upset. Sorry, I'm full. I have no room for being discouraged. I'm full. I'm filled with joy and encouragement. I have no room for the disappointment. I have no room for the stuff. Just try to lift your hands one more time. See what happens to you. telling you, the Holy Ghost is brooding over this place tonight. He's brooding over here. I tell you, God is brooding over this place. There are many people in here who so want to be pleasing to the Lord. You so want to be pleasing to the Lord that you've written Jesus out of it. You so want to be pleasing to the Lord that you're not relying on the Holy Ghost. We want you back out of that. Hey, you went out the wrong way. Just receive right now. There's the power of the Holy Spirit is here to strengthen you, refreshing you, empower you, so you don't live your life that way no more. Jason, come here. Jason, come here. And your brother too, Jeremy, come here. Listen to me. You know what the Lord would like for you to do? Can I tell you what the Lord would like for you to do? He doesn't want you to pay attention to you anymore. He's like, look up here. Just pay attention to me from now on. I know that's going to be a challenge because I know you're really captivated by yourself. And you're working yourself all out and getting yourself all figured out and working straightened out. But he's really tired of that. And he would like for you to stop doing that. He would actually like you to stop critiquing his handiwork. He really doesn't need it. He would actually prefer and would be very excited and blessed if you would just start telling him how good a work he does, his great job he's doing, and that you find no fault with him. And that he's amazing and that he's beautiful and he's wonderful and you can't find the adjectives to fully express it all, but you're going to continue on trying. And the same thing goes for you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of the Most High God. Find all your confidence in Him. All your fulfillment in what He's already done. Not in what you've got to do. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. It's a wonderful and glorious thing, and especially when you're going through adverse circumstances, to be overwhelmed with the knowledge of how much Father loves you and how He's there at work in the midst of your life, even when you don't feel deserving, even when you don't feel worthy. None of this even started with deserving and worthy. It all started by His grace and by His mercy and by His love. We want you to discover the goodness of God. We want you to see that goodness and mercy follows you all the days of your life. Amen. Not every other week, once a month, on Christmas and special holidays. It's certain intervals of time when you've done really extra, especially good. All the days of your life. And that you should dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And that Father, Jesus said, Father, keep through your own name those that you've given to me. Wow. I pray that you get just so rooted and grounded and settled in love tonight that then you'll be able to see. Then you'll be able to comprehend. Then you'll be able to understand. Then you'll be able to begin to move with God in the knowledge of the Lord. Hallelujah. There, dwelling in this love that passes knowledge, be filled with all of His fullness, to just find yourself just without any effort, just being enriched. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the living God. Praise the name of the living God. Dosto roko shiata la masatiya praboth. Hallelujah. You see, somebody said, well, what are we doing? We're just waiting on the Lord. We're just waiting on God. In other words, we're just yielding ourselves to Him. Giving Him an opportunity to take full control, move, lead, guide, direct, speak. You don't need to be doing a war dance to get God to move. You don't need to be screaming on top of your lungs to get the power of God to be poured out. Just wait. Sit down in His presence and wait. Just enjoy the good presence of the living God. See, I'm being filled right now. Do I look like I'm being filled? I am. I'm being filled right now. I'm being filled. I'm being overwhelmed by the presence of the Spirit of the Lord right now. I know I'm not breaking out into psalms and hymns and spiritual song, but I'm giving thanks. There's an expression of the divine power of God and of His grace. Father wants this for you all the time. Is there anybody standing here, sitting, in whatsoever the case may be, and you have need? There's a miracle that you've petitioned God for, and that you can believe tonight, this moment and this time, that tonight would be the night that that petition would be granted, that the breakthrough would come for that miracle that you've been asking, Father, for. Or maybe it's something that you've never even petitioned the Lord for. Maybe it's an event that's just recent. And you're willing to believe tonight that God would intervene, step into the midst of the situation and bring His love, His miracle, His provision, His power, His peace. If you want to step out, take hold of that. I want you to come. Father's here to meet you. He's here to touch you. You know, one thing about hunger and thirst that God the Holy Spirit produces in our life, it is tenacious. It's not going to stop seeking. Hunger's not going to stop seeking until it gets fed. Thirst is not going to stop seeking and pursuing until it gets a drink. Huh? If you were thirsty, just desperately thirsty tonight, and I told you, there's a bottle of water here, but it's hidden somewhere, you're going to have to look for it. I guarantee you're going to tear the place apart. If you're real thirsty, you're going to tear the place apart. You're not just going to look around and say, well, I don't see it. That's right. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus.